Going live, doing it. We're live.
All right.
All right. Welcome back, everybody, to another exciting episode of Red Dot Forum Camera Talk. As always, I am your host, David Farkas, joined by my co-host, Josh Lair.
Hello.
We've got Jose Rivera producing the show for us.
Hello, hello.
And Kirsten Vignes in the comments, keeping an eye on your questions and letting us know. So today we are coming back to the world of cameras after kind of venturing into a little bit of computer and workflow and other things.
A little bit.
But you know, we can't stay away from cameras, and specifically, we love lenses, right?
Yes. Today's episode.
So what are we talking about?
Today's episode is about Leica's L-Mount Lenses. So that's going to be lenses and adapters for the SL, SL2, TL2, the CL, all of their L-Mount cameras. Mm-hmm. I should mention, we are talking about Leica L-Mount Lenses. We'll have more about that later as to why that clarification is important. But we've talked about the SL system, the CL system, the TL system. We spent a lot of time on cameras. We felt it was appropriate after receiving a lot of questions about lenses and lens selection and lens options to do a whole episode dedicated just to the optics. So we're not going to talk about camera settings and all that stuff. Today is just about lenses in Leica's L-mount system. So we should probably start by explaining a little bit what is the L-mount and the L-mount alliance. What does that mean? I know you've written about that quite a bit, so
I have.
Why don't you just take it away?
Yeah, and as a reminder, as always, guys, we've got tons of relevant links down in the comments below, so you can see those either on your phone or on the computer, both in the live stream as well as when this gets archived on YouTube as a regular video. So check out the links. I've got basically just tons of coverage that we've done on Red Dot Forum over the years, between lens reviews as well as interviews with product managers, with Dr. Kaufman talking about it specifically, and also of the event back in 2018 at Photokina where they announced the L-Mount Alliance. So basically, the Alliance is centered around the Leica L-Mount. That's the L-Mount right there. Look at that. And we'll get into it a little later, but basically, Leica has been joined by Panasonic and Sigma as alliance members. So it's not a partnership. It is an alliance. They're very specific about that. And essentially, Leica is licensing the technology of the lens mount that they fully developed themselves to Panasonic and Sigma to broaden the market for the L-mount in general, both with lenses and with cameras. So you can put a Leica L-mount lens onto a Panasonic L-mount body, or you can put a Sigma lens onto a Leica L-mount body with full compatibility. And this is what the alliance is. It's just to basically broaden the options for the user. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely a win-win for us as photographers.
Yeah.
And so far, it's been great. So that's basically the L-Mount Alliance in a nutshell. But why don't we talk a little bit about the origins? Were the SL lenses the first L-Mount lenses?
They were not. So it's easy to forget that the L-Mount, before it was called the L-Mount, mm-hmm. began in 2014.
Yep.
Or really, I'm sure it developed before, but it launched mm-hmm. in the spring of 2014 with the original T, Type 701, mm-hmm. which was an APS-C sensor camera, not full frame, and sort of started, that's the TL2,
which
is where it
yep.
is now. That's what started this mount. At the time, it was called the T-mount and mm-hmm. then the TL-mount, and then once the SL came out, simply the L-mount. If we say TL lens or SL lens, really you can interchange that with full frame for SL lens, crop sensor
yep.
for TL lens. But it is important to note that the mount is the same.
Yes.
Obviously, the L-mount. Mm-hmm. So even though some lenses are covering full frame and some lenses are covering APS-C, mm-hmm. it is the exact same mount. So when you mount these lenses on various cameras, you know, SL lenses on TLs and vice versa, there's no adapters. It just fits. which is really, I think, the beauty of of that system.
It is really nice.
Yeah. So we'll talk a lot more about that. But that is where the, so it's been six years.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. 6 years of L-mount
lenses. Which is really crazy when you think about it. In just 6 years, you can see what's in front of us here. How many lenses we went from. We went from zero. It didn't exist in early 2014.
Yeah.
So 6 years later, we have two full lineups. I'm sure there's gaps and they'll be filled over time.
Well, and I think it was actually really quick because in 2015, at the end of, in October 2015, the Leica launched the SL601. Mm-hmm. And one of the big selling points of that camera is they came out with adapters that could use M lenses. Well, actually, that already existed with the T.
Yeah.
R lenses, same with the T.
Yeah.
And also announced a line of new lenses. And even Leica actually provided L-mount specs to Novaflex, who makes adapters. You might even have a couple over there, to actually have compatibility to Nikon and Canon lenses even. You know, so they're not first-party adapters, but Leica certainly allowed Novaflex to make those adapters and to open up the L-mount enough where they could do that. So when the...
Enzo's making an appearance.
Oh, okay. over there.
Yeah, he's like there.
So basically, when the SL601 launched, they had a slide on the screen, and it said that it was compatible with like 300 lenses from launch day, which was incredible.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, to have a brand new mirrorless professional camera that immediately had lens compatibility, and now we've seen over the last 5 years, you know, in the front row here, these are all native SL lenses. Everything else is basically either a TL lens or M lenses, S lenses, R lenses, anything that can be adapted. So
yeah, we have five primes and three zooms, so eight lenses total as for the SL system in 5 years, which is
it's not bad,
pretty good considering how complicated they have to be and
very
a lot
much
of focus
so.
And
very
all that
so.
Good stuff. So we should probably get to some questions since we've been rambling quite a bit. And again, as David mentioned, he has done tons and tons of written content over the years on SL lenses, TL lenses, with tons of images. So you can certainly peruse the links in the article description, and then just browse red.forum to find some of that stuff. So
yep,
yeah, we should start with, well, before I bug Jose to look at the some of the questions we've had ahead of time. Anything good in the comments? Because I feel like we always forget about the early questions because
right.
Very...
Well, there's a lot of hellos. Hi guys.
Hello.
We see you.
Yes,
thanks.
We see you. What do we got? I don't have a computer this time, so
Let's see.
Western Australia.
There's a lot.
Wow.
Okay.
That is very far away.
Early question. Okay.
Sure.
So here's an early question. Can the firmware of TL lenses be updated through an SL2 camera update, or must a TLCL camera body be used? That is a really good question.
No, it's both. You can use, that's the beauty of the L-mount alliance, and even just in-house, is a CL and an SL2, as long as the camera has the latest firmware, that's the key. The camera has to have the latest firmware. So our 3.7 for the SL, 2.0 for the SL2, and 4.0 for
CL2,
the CL.
4.0.
Right, this came out. All the firmware updates for the lenses are built in. So that's actually a good lead into, if you buy one of these cameras, the first
you
thing
you
do-
You want to point out that?
Well, the first thing you do is update the firmware on the body.
Yep.
Then you mount your lens. You do the body firmware with no lens attached. Then you mount your lens with the camera off, turn the camera on, wait a second, because the lens firmware is stored inside of the camera's firmware.
Mm-hmm.
So what the camera will do is it will scan the lens's firmware version, and if it detects that the camera's firmware has a newer lens firmware version than what's on the lens already,
it will automatically update
the lens. But there is sometimes a short delay.
Sometimes
and
a little longer.
What you don't want to do is go out into the field before doing that, and you're about to take your shot, and it goes lens firmware updating, and you're like, it takes a few minutes. So.
Yeah, so raise your hand if that's happened to you.
Yes, to both of us. That's why we know. and that also is why I'm going to have, if we have a close-up on this, the sticker.
Here.
This throws a lot of people off because L-mount lenses, when they come out of the box, have this orange sticker on the mount, which is basically warning you to use firmware version maybe 1.4 or whatever it says, or newer.
Right.
And that's actually referring to the original T and the TL. because those cameras, because they came before SL lenses ever existed, need to have a certain version of the firmware, pretty old at this point, but a certain version of the firmware installed.
1.4, yeah,
in order to be compatible with SL lenses. So it's like a warning to say, this is not going to work.
Right, you didn't want to put where basically the lens firmware was older.
No, newer.
Or newer, rather, a lot newer. Yeah. A lot newer than the camera firmware because it causes incompatibility.
Right, so that's what that sticker means. So if you don't have an original T or TL,
don't worry about
it. You don't have that sticker, it's just disregarded. Yeah.
Yeah, because this lens came out after the introduction of the CL and the SL2 and everything. So,
or not SL2, SL. That lens came out after.
I'm saying like this.
Yeah.
Came out before. Sorry. Yeah. Before all like, of these.
Okay. So anyway.
Yeah. The cameras are newer than the lens.
As long as your camera has the latest firmware, CL or SL, they'll be able to update all the lenses. That's the key. It has to have the latest firmware. Mm-hmm. And make sure, of course, when you do your firmware, you have a fully charged battery in there, because if it's doing firmware on a camera and then on a lens or a few lenses,
it needs.
You don't want to have a half-charged battery that could die and, you know, bad news.
And these are actually really good things, because as part of one of the firmware updates in the camera that included an updated lens firmware for the 50mm 1.4 Summilux SL, and the autofocus speed significantly improved.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That wasn't in the camera. That was actually lens firmware to change the motor behavior.
Yeah.
So you always want to be on the latest version. That's another reason to stay on top of your camera firmware updates.
Right, and when there is a camera firmware update, what I always do is, let's say I have an SL2 and three lenses.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever the new firmware comes out for the SL2, I install that, get that done, and then I mount each lens at the house.
Just to make sure.
Nothing's going on. Mount each lens to make sure that the lens doesn't just say, oh, firmware updating. Because again, I don't want that to happen when I'm out shooting. So just a little top tip for lens firmware updating. So that was a good question.
Yeah, got that out of the way.
Okay,
so let's see here. Whoop, I just got pushed down.
Sorry, Jose, we're gonna get to you. we're just gonna what do we got?
That's
what, James?
Yeah, James says, I have a TL55-135. That's a TL lens.
Yeah.
For my TL2 that snapped off at the lens mount.
What? What did you do? Sorry.
We've never seen that.
Can you send me a picture of that? I'm actually very curious.
We are legitimately, I have never seen any of these lenses on this table have the lens mount separate from from the lens.
Yeah. If you need any help with that, you have my email. We spoke like a week ago. So.
Okay.
Crazy. Yeah. All right. Keep going. What else we got?
Not so much an answer as a wow.
Yeah. Wow. Interesting. I want to, actually, I know the answer, I think, to Jeffrey's question. Well, that's a quick answer.
Okay. Jeffrey asks, why doesn't the Sigma L lenses work with the
back button?
The back button focus the way the SL lenses do.
Now, I don't know a lot about, I really don't know anything about the Sigma and Panasonic lenses, because David and I are Leica nerds, and we know what we don't know. But what I have seen, and correct me if I'm wrong, if this is true on all of them, but the Sigma lenses that have a AF, MF, you know, an autofocus, manual focus
switch,
a hard switch on the lens,
all of
that
them do.
Overrides the camera's ability to allow you to back button focus. It's some functionality incompatibility there that I've seen.
And that might be addressed in firmware update.
Yeah.
So something about the L-Mount Alliance that I learned, which was interesting, and it's in one of my articles where I interviewed, I think it was maybe 2 days after the announcement, I sat down with Stefan Schultz, who's the head of professional products at Leica. And we talked about the L-Mount Alliance and how it worked. And basically, the fact that Sigma can have a manual focus, autofocus switch on their lens, but Leica doesn't have it, it's in the specification. So what they do is the Alliance members all meet up a few times a year, and they propose different features and options, and then they all actually agree, with Leica having a little bit more of a vote. Everyone's equal, but Leica's a little more equal. As to whether that feature will be supported across the board. Because let's say that Leica and Panasonic think that's a good idea, but now Sigma has to implement support for all of that. So that's kind of the way it works, is these are supported features, but it doesn't necessarily dictate the behavior.
Right.
So in the case of the back button, you could use that switch, you know, switched lens, let's say the Panasonic with an MF, AF switch on it, physically on the barrel, and you can use it on a CL or an SL or an SL2, and it'll work perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm.
But it may not activate on the back button focus.
Right, because the SL or the SL2 to activate the back button focus, you have to, or back button focus only, you have to switch it into MF mode. But if the lens has an MF switch on it,
yeah,
that overrides the cameras. So it's like, yeah, I'm sure that's something that can be addressed, because back button focus is something that David and
I love it.
Preach pretty,
yeah,
you know, actively. So good question.
All right.
Well, you had one that you wanted to ask, right, David? Or you saw, I can ask.
Yeah, yeah, here. You want to ask that one?
Ballo's question?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Sorry if I butchered your name. I'm really interested in the Apo 35. I have the Apo 50 and love it. Would you say these two are more similar or more different, and in which way? So we've got them both here.
We do.
I will give to you.
That's a 50.
And a 35.
And a 35. There.
Yeah, as you can see, they look exactly the same.
Love. Yeah, if I turn them this way, you'd never know which is which. So one of the cool things about the Apo Summicron SL range, and right now that's, one is backwards still.
Yeah, there you go.
Doing great. Here we, nope.
The other one.
There we go.
You got this.
Thank you.
There you go. Good work.
Okay, we've got 35 and we've got 50. So they are identical barrel dimensions. They do look a little different in terms of the glass design in the front. You can see the front element is not identical. But otherwise, they will look identical. They do weigh a little bit different. Let's
There's
see.
There's a 10-gram difference.
Yeah.
I think the 35 is 10 grams heavier.
Slightly different.
Nominal.
One of the design goals of the Apo Summicron SLs was to have the same barrel dimensions across the board and a lot of shared components, be it, you know, shared aperture control, autofocus control, which would make manufacturing easier and also be just a better user experience, because with the lenses being more uniform, it allows you to use them, let's say, if you're doing video, to use them in a video rig without having to change the distance to your matte box. Mm. You can use the same exact filter rings on everything. So it's pretty cool. The only thing is, when they're in your camera bag, pointing this way, you're
label
like,
them.
Yeah. So what I'd recommend is you can get a little label maker and put the focal length on the back.
Yeah.
But as far as the look, I would say that they are going to have a very similar appearance. They're going to have a very similar rendering because, again, that was one of the design goals, is to create this uniformity across the range, mm-hmm. where very similar to how cine lenses are designed, where they have a very, very consistent design language, a very consistent feel and look of the images. And that's a good thing because it allows you to change your focal length without changing your whole look. There is lenses that look different, like say the 50 Summilux, SL, that is going to have a pretty dramatically different look than the 50.
We have a question about that.
So we have a question about that. But basically, they're going to look really, really similar. If you're happy with one, you're going to be pleased as punch with the other.
Yeah.
And vice versa. And I know there was another question about this, which is, which one should I get? Which one is better? It's just whichever focal length you feel more inclined to base your system around.
Yeah.
And ultimately, it's a good thing that they look so similar, because they're both reference class performers. They are ridiculously sharp, pleasing, you know, really nice out of focus areas, even corner to corner, edge to edge.
You have to remember
all of it.
You know, when you think about the, let's say, lenses that we know and love, like the M lenses, mm-hmm. they were designed over a period of many, many years, all the different versions.
Yes.
Whereas the SL lenses were pretty much designed all at the same time.
Well, these were designed exactly at
the
same time.
So with the SL Apo primes, I mean. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you may say a 35 lux M lens and a 50 lux M lens are very different because they were designed 10 years apart.
They were.
Or whatever, give or take. Whereas mm-hmm. these were all designed at the same time. So mm-hmm. the luxury that Leica had was giving you an actual lens line
mm-hmm.
where you're switching between focal lengths, and your bokeh is going to be a little different, and But the overall look
mm-hmm.
is going to be very similar because they were designed in concert, which is which is nice. You know, if you've got a system going and you are working and you need to maintain the same look, you can just be bouncing between those four and soon to be, or eventually to be seven. One day.
Yeah.
and they maintain the same look, which is pretty impressive. So
it is.
Jose has so many questions people submitted ahead of time. So why don't you pick one for us?
All right. Well, since you guys did mention the 250 SLs,
mm-hmm.
That is one of the questions. Can you comment on the optical differences between the 50 Summicron SL and 50 Summilux SL?
Sure. I've shot a lot with both.
You want to grab it?
The big difference, I mean, the difference that is hard for people to get past is the size difference and the weight difference, right? Because this is the 50 Summilux SL. This is the 50 Apo SL. Obviously, the 50 Summilux is larger. It's an 82 millimeter filter thread versus a 67. Here we go. You can see them next to each other versus a 67. So we've got 67 here, 82 here. There's the front. So 514 SL weighs in at 1,065 grams. 50 F2 is 740 grams. So it's considerably lighter. So you may say, well, if this lens is smaller and lighter, why would I want the 514 SL? And the answer is very similar to the decisions that you make when you're picking an M lens, which is you're after a look. The 514 is the closest experience you'll have with an SL lens looking like an M lens, but sharper, more modern, but still looks like an M lens. The focus fall off, the bokeh is very Summilux-like.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's a 50 Summilux. It sounds silly to say that, but what I mean is, you compare it to a 50 Summilux M, and even though this 514 SL is sharper, has less chromatic aberration, mm-hmm. and focuses a little bit closer than the M lens, of course, it's still going to look and feel more like an M lens, with more of that different kind of micro contrast, mm-hmm. a little more vignetting, and again, a very, very fast focus fall off. So if you've got, let's say, a 35 and a 90 SL Apo, mm-hmm. and you're looking for a 50, you may go for the 514 because it is going to look different.
I like that, yeah.
Yeah, because you may, someone may say, well, I'm a working pro, and I gotta have all my lenses look the same, and you mm-hmm. just get the four Apos and you mm-hmm. call it a day. Other people may say, well, I've already got the two Apos that are just mind-blowingly yep. sharp and insane. I want something that's still autofocus, that's still weather sealed, that's still mm-hmm. an SL native lens and all the benefits that it comes with, but I want something to look different. And that's where the Summilux SL comes into play. And I know that it is certainly larger, but it is a little bit smaller and lighter than the 24 to 90, which mm-hmm. is a lens that if you have an SL or an SL2,
you got a
probably used yeah. it at one point. And it's a little bit smaller than that, slightly, 10% maybe.
So I'm actually going to kick over here, Jose, just go over my screen. Before I do that. So I did a review of the 50 Summilux SL when it came out because it was kind of different.
Yeah.
So I wanted to give that look because I'd say it does look different than 24 to 90. It looks yeah. different than the Apo SLs.
Yeah, it's the only native Summilux lens for the SL system. Now, let me yeah. just state one thing. The 50 Apo is sharper. Mm-hmm. I don't want to make any misconceptions here. If your objective is the highest level of image quality, especially in the corners, 50 Apo SL.
I'd say, I would emphasize that, especially in the corners, because yes. dead on in the middle.
Yeah, they're the same. Yeah.
But not only is it the same, and this is a little surprising, and I have it in the review, I have sample pictures that the 50 Summilux at 1.4 is actually sharper than the 50 Apo Summicron M, which again is a reference class design and one of the sharpest M lenses ever
yeah.
made.
Yeah.
So when I compared these lenses, and that's not a fair comparison because I'm not comparing these at F2. I'm comparing this at F2 and that at 1.4, and at 1.4 it was still sharper.
Yeah.
So I just want to kick over here just to kind of give you an idea of the feel. I have a couple of pictures I think that demonstrate that. So let's take a quick look. So this is just on red.forum here, under reviews, and you can find the 50 Summilux review. So have a little bit of the design. This is kind of an interesting thing when we talk a little bit more maybe about M lenses, is here, I did not want to do that. Gestures, all right, there we go. So you can see that we've got the 50 Summilux SL on the left, a 50 Summilux M right next to it. So those are the same focal length, the same maximum aperture, and they're both full frame lenses, which is pretty insane in terms of the size. So, but it does give you obviously autofocus, weather sealing, and all that. So I think I even showed this in a previous live stream, but what I like about this photo, it really demonstrates a bit of that character that we're talking about, where it is, you know, pinpoint sharpness on these eyelashes and that eye, and you can see the individual hairs are just, you know, really well resolved, and then it just falls off into creamy, dreamy land. And it's very, very gradual, very gentle. The bokeh is just smooth as butter. So this was a pretty busy background. You can see there's other people at a park here. And it was able to just isolate this really nicely. So that's kind of an example, you know, or, you know, another example of kind of that bokeh and that biting sharpness in the foreground, and then it just falls off very naturally. What Josh is talking about in terms of the corners and kind of that, this kind of demonstrate that in terms of the fall off here and a little bit of that natural vignetting, it actually is really pleasing. You can see on this example where it's not just those kind of ugly, black, harsh corners. It's very gradual and really brings your eye in to the center of the frame. So it can be a creative tool with the vignetting.
Yeah, I do want to talk about another comment I get sometimes from people, or maybe they'll read it online, is like, oh, the 50 Summilux SL, the autofocus is unusable, it's so slow. Now, I will say when the lens was first introduced, the autofocus was pretty darn slow. They fixed that with a firmware update. It's not as fast as a 50 Summicron, definitely not. The reason is because it is dead on accurate. Mm. When you think about the size of the lens elements inside and how little depth of field there is with a Summilux SL lens, in order for that autofocus to be accurate, it's going to have to be a little bit slower. But you could put that, I use the spot, we call it a spot focus point on the SL2, so the little crosshair. You put that crosshair over somebody's eye,
it's dead on.
It's perfect. I mean, it's so accurate that you'll understand why it's a little bit more, I'll say, it works a little harder.
Yeah, and it's a lot of glass to move.
Yeah. So if focus speed is your goal, get a 50 Apo, right? I don't have a problem saying that because they're two different tools for two different tasks. If you've owned a 51-4 M lens for years and you love the way that lens looks, you get an SL2 and you're looking for the same look or the closest look you can, but up to the modern era, get a 50 Lux SL. That's how it comes down.
Here, I'll show you one other shot when Josh talks about that pinpoint sharpness.
Yeah.
So this is a really exciting shot of some lockers.
Oh, fun.
I mean, this is exciting, right? Right, and you can see this is in a dark, artificial light.
Yeah, what ISO is that at?
This is at, well,
800.
Okay.
On the original SL.
An original SL, not the SL2.
Yeah.
So this is 24 megapixel, not 47. Just want to lay that out there. And I've got 100% crop here.
I don't know how much they're going to see on YouTube, but...
I'm going to zoom in.
Ah, look at that.
Now, I think that that's pretty sharp for a 1.4 handheld in a darkened loading bay by artificial lighting.
Yeah, and
with,
not stabilized.
With autofocus.
Right. This is the original SL, so no stabilization.
No image stabilization. And what's amazing is think about how much more detail we'd get with the SL2.
Yeah.
And the benefit of image stabilization.
Oh, yeah. So again, the 50 Apo SL is unbelievably good. And if we talk about this, so depending on your objectives, there's not a right answer. It just depends on what you're looking for. Let's get to the next question because I have spent way too much time on this. Jose, what do you got?
All right. So will in-body stabilization work on the CL if you're using 24-90 and 90-280 SL lenses?
Well, not in-body image stabilization, because the CL and the TL2 don't have in-body image stabilization. Only the SL2 does. But if you mean the in-lens stabilization, then yes, they will. So you're able to use the two lenses that have built-in optical stabilization are the 24-90 and the 90-280. Okay, so if you use those on the SL2 that has also in-body image stabilization, it'll actually combine both to work in concert.
Yeah.
And I think it's an effective 6 stops.
A lot, but.
Yeah.
But
to come back to the other question, you can use that on a CL and it'll still give you 3 stops roughly of optical image stabilization.
When you mount a 90-280 or 24-90 on the CL, the stabilization option in the menu becomes ungrayed out. So you can turn it on or off as you need it. So one of those two lenses is how you get image stabilization on the CL. Yeah, a little bit oddly sized, but it does work. It does
the camera kind of hangs off the back.
Yeah.
And really, this is still a great option because it kind of creates a natural telephoto extender. And instead of 90-280, you're actually getting 135 to 420 millimeter equivalent.
That to take us into what is a question we get all the time, which I think Jose has on there from Jack, right?
Just leave that up there.
Yeah, we're going to talk about this right now.
Will Leica come out with a tele extender for SL?
So the real the real question there is, thank you, Jack, for that, is telephoto options for, let's talk about for the SL2, since that's what's current, beyond 280 millimeter. And the short answer is, at the moment, there is no native SL lens longer than 280. The 980-280, which David just
no,
said.
No Leica option.
That's what I mean. There's no Leica SL lens longer than 280 millimeter.
There, we should mention, we don't know about it. Yes. We haven't shot with it. Yeah. But Sigma does make a 100 to 400 millimeter L-mount lens full frame.
We have not used it. So we cannot say anything good or bad about it because we are totally ignorant.
Now, we can tell you that it exists.
If anybody has used it, please comment, because we're genuinely curious what the experience has been. So that said, what are your options? Well, there's a lot. We're just going to talk about a few. The first one is, and this was more relevant in the original SL days, less relevant now. With the original SL, if you cropped to APS-C mode, you had 10 megapixels. So we would say, well, just take the 90-280, put it on a CL.
Yep.
It becomes 135 to 420.
With 24 megapixels.
Right. But now with the SL2 having 47 megapixels, you could simply activate the APS-C mode in the SL2. It gives you 20 megapixels.
Splitting. With in-body plus lens stabilization.
Yeah. So I think the argument about a CL being like an SL extender is less relevant now.
Yeah.
Because the SL2's resolution offers enough to act it as its own extender, which is pretty cool. Of course, let's say you want the full 47 megapixels and you want lower than 280 millimeters. What are your options? Well, nothing that Leica makes. Nothing that is autofocus, unless you start going to like Canon or with the Sigma MC21.
Right. Well, that's true, right. You know. So if you have a NovaFlex, let's say a Nikon adapter, you can use it, but very specifically, you can only use the E-type lenses, which have built-in autofocus motors. And it happens to be that most of those lenses, I think it's 11 different Nikon lenses, and we have a list on Red.Forum Forum when that was announced. But lenses like a 600 f/4 are in there.
Yeah, I haven't tried that. I mean, this is getting out of our expertise, but there are ways to do it. There's no native way. Leica, of course, has made teleconverters in the past. This is, for example, a 2x APO extender for the R system. So then naturally, if you have R lenses, you can use this 2x extender to have Leica full frame lenses longer than 280.
I will demonstrate.
David has, well, Jose's got it on me already, so I'll show it.
You want to show it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is, I'll just say, this is my lens here.
Yes.
It's missing its red dot, but yeah, well, this is my, that's pretty nice. Yeah. This is my 180 2.8 APO lens.
Oh, you got it, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so now, what we're going to do now, so this is
and it's pretty compact.
This
I
is
just want
Leica,
to show you.
A Leica R 180 2.8 lens. So manual focus, manual aperture.
Just want to demonstrate that it's not much larger than the 35. It's actually the same front filter diameter, 67. Much bigger piece of glass, but not much bigger, really.
Well, not without the two adapters you're going to need. But
Not without the adapters. But this is a pretty compact 180 lens, which is why I like it. I use this on the M system as well, because it works nicely. But I'm going to mount
First the extender. The first thing David's going to do, I'll talk about you while you show. So he's holding the 180 2.8R lens and the R 2X APO extender. Okay, so he's going to mount.
It's worth pointing out, though, you notice, unlike a macro adapter, you can see that there's something in this that is not typically in a macro adapter.
There's glass.
There is glass. This is actually uses optical elements in here to magnify.
So now he's going to mount this onto the 180R lens and boom, like that. And then he's going to mount the R adapter L, which is another Leica made adapter.
And this there's no glass, you can see.
Just an adapter. That's going to allow David to now have a 360 millimeter f5.6 Leica lens full frame on the SL2. Now, of course, it's manual focus, it's manual aperture, but it does work. It works pretty well. And because the SL2 is stabilized, you are going to have a stabilized 360 5.6. Not fantastic in low light, but if you're shooting this kind of stuff, it's probably outdoors during the day.
But the SL2 is pretty good for low light ability. Yeah. So
look at that. That is cool.
And this has really nice focus. Actually, Leica patented this ball bearing focus mechanism just for this lens.
There you go. So that is one way of having full frame, 360 millimeter.
In a size, when we compare it.
Yeah, pretty close.
It's a little shorter.
There you go, take that out. Shorter, but not dramatically so. You know, and then you have to decide, do you want to go through all of that to get an extra 80 millimeters, or do you just want to crop the 90-280 by some amount?
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, then you could start going into, you know, Leica's made a 400-28 and these Apo
right.
Tele modular system, and that stuff is enormous and it's crazy expensive. So honestly, if you need a 600F4 autofocus lens, you probably shouldn't use an SL2.
Didn't they make a 400-5.6 or?
They made an 800-6.3.
Oh, the 800-6.3.
Yeah.
Mostly empty too.
Yeah, it's wild. So there just isn't yet a viable super telephoto lens for the SL2. I think if it came out, it would be ludicrously expensive and extremely rarely purchased. So I don't imagine Leica is going to do that. It's just, you know, not every camera can do everything. And I'm certainly mm-hmm. happy to admit when something hits the wall and it can't do it, at least not natively. And that's okay, because Leica isn't trying to appease everyone all the time.
Right.
You know, they have it just like any other company. They have a market segment. And I think the 90-280, even cropped on the SL2.
It's phenomenal.
Is amazing. I mean, it's still 20 megapixels of that fantastic 47 meg sensor. It's not like you're giving up anything other than pixels. So.
Yep.
Whew. That was a discussion.
That was a discussion.
Well, I'm sure we'll come back to
that. You're mostly having it with yourself. It was great.
Well, I'm very entertaining. Have you not met me? What's
all
next?
Right.
There's a lot of commentary, but let's before we get to that, guys, keep hitting us with the comments, but we do want to get to these questions that were emailed ahead of time. Because
we
tend to gloss over those.
Trick, if you want to get your question answered on air, submit it ahead of time. It's a much higher likelihood because we put them onto a spreadsheet and ask them all. So what am I doing?
We have a question.
Oh, yeah. Actually,
what?
Oh, it's worth mentioning.
Yes.
That if you use that combo,
mm-hmm.
the 360 millimeter 5.6,
mm-hmm.
but use it in APS mode at 20 megapixels,
ooh.
We are getting
720 millimeters.
No, it's not 2x.
Oh, no, it's 1.5, sorry. 550?
560?
We are.
Let's see.
We're so bad.
360 times 540.
540, yeah, okay. I was getting
that's that. Pretty good. So you'd have a 540 millimeter f5.6 with image stabilization in a very hand-holdable package. So for me, that seems like a great birding or safari setup.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a lot lighter weight.
Good luck finding one of those. You can't have this one.
You can't have that one.
It's David's.
It is mine. But you can also find, they made a really excellent 183.4 Apo,
yeah.
Which is optically about as good as that. This is a little mechanically smoother, but they're roughly the same size, and you can probably find the 3.4 for a lot less money.
We're going to have to talk about that question on the bottom there. Let Jose ask one first.
Yeah, we'll get to
that. That's a very long discussion.
We'll get to that.
What time is it? We've got to get into the meat of it. All right. What's next?
All right. Question from David that came in earlier. What is considered the sweet spot for the 35 Apo? When does diffraction become an issue?
I'll take that.
Yeah.
So it's not about the lens. It's a really big misconception that diffraction is lens related. Diffraction is camera dependent, specifically sensor dependent. The higher the resolution of the sensor, the smaller the pixels are, the sooner you get diffraction in terms of as you stop down. So one of the reasons that Leica stayed with 24 megapixels for so long across their bodies, that gave a 6 micron pixel size, which allowed you to shoot at roughly f11, f13. Now that we've gone to 47 megapixels, I think it's a 4.2 micron pixel size, somewhere in there. It's more like f8, f9 is where you're hitting diffraction. So as you keep increasing resolution, pixels have to keep getting smaller and smaller and smaller. You can't stop down as much. So it's definitely a trade-off. And I think that's, you're not sacrificing anything in terms of sharpness on the lenses for sure, because these lenses perform optimally from wide open on. These aren't, gone are the days where you have to stop it down 2 stops to get the best resolution. You're getting the best resolution from go, I mean, at any setting. But keep in mind, don't think that if you stop down to F16, it's going to be sharper than at F11 because it's going to be worse. So really mind your aperture and I think that's also why it's so important with the tool that's on the SL, SL2. We've got the top display, and in manual focus mode, you can see a live readout of your depth of field. Mm. And that allows you to control your depth of field within within the diffraction limits.
We should spend some time on that a little bit later, just because I know there's a question about that. I do want to get to, since we're kind of right in the sweet spot of the show, the big question from SD Rohde up, about the M word.
Let's not talk about that yet.
You don't want to talk about that
yet? No, not yet.
All right. You tell me when you're ready, because that's a big one. That's like a 20 minute.
We're going to talk about macro, because we know you guys love macro.
That's right, a 20 minute discussion.
But we want to make sure that we're going to give a little breather, and then we'll get into it.
Okay.
But let's try to hit some more questions.
Yeah, what do you got, Jose?
I got to go in here. Would a 21 millimeter Summilux M lens, along with an adapter on an SL2, be weatherproof? Or do I need to wait until Leica releases the SL Summicron
L-Mount? I'll let you handle that. That's an easy one.
No.
There you go.
So the weatherproofing system that is in the SL and the SL system is based around the entire system. If you mount an M lens, which is not weather sealed, onto an SL2, which is weather sealed, sure, the SL2 itself is still sealed, but the lens mount and forward is not. If you look at the back of an SL lens, if I could find one, there is...
I'll do it here.
No, Jose's moving it.
Here.
There's gasket on the lens mount. That is part of the camera's ceiling, weather ceiling. I don't know if you'll be able to see it.
Yeah, just kind of give it a little flick there.
I'm going to catch it just right.
That's it.
You see it there? Yeah, so it's a piece of rubber that's just keeping the water out. So,
but that's just on the mount.
Yes.
You're not seeing all of the rings.
On the inside. Yeah,
all the O-rings that are sealing everywhere.
Yeah. An M lens, a CL lens, none of those lenses that are adapted to the SL2 will be weather sealed. The only adapted lenses that are weather sealed with the SL or the SL2 are S lenses.
You got it right.
That's because S lenses, very much like SL lenses, are weather sealed because the S system is a weather sealed system. And the S adapter L, which allows you to mount S lenses onto the SL, maintains that weather sealing with the same gasket. So the SL and S lenses with the S adapter L are weather sealed fully on the SL or the SL2. No other lenses are weather sealed. Question answer.
Mm-hmm.
Next.
Solid. Not to say that an M21 wouldn't be a great lens to use on an SL.
It's okay. Honestly, I talked about this on the wide angle episode.
Yeah.
I like the 24 Lux better, or the 21 Super Elmar.
21 Super Elmar would be my recommendation.
So nice
too.
On the SL. Yeah. Of course, Leica will eventually come out with the 21, an Apo Summicron SL 21 millimeter f2 ASPH. I assume they've announced that they're going to do it at some point. So then that'll be.
I think it's coming the end of last year. It's coming
out.
It's
going to be a good year whenever it comes out. So.
It's going to be amazing.
Yeah. Hopefully everybody's staying real healthy because we need to live long lives. Jose, what else you got?
Question from Andrew. Where can I get the Leica thermos that's in front of David? Oh, that's a lens.
We do have I don't know where it is, but we do have a thermos.
Right here.
Do you have one floating around
somewhere? Yeah.
Are you literally going to leave the studio? Bye. He's never done this before. What if I just closed the door and locked it? Then it's just you guys and me for the rest of the night. We can do whatever you want.
I'm back.
No more dropping things. Oh, he's here.
I'm here. All right. Did they say anything bad about me?
Probably.
Yes, this is available, actually.
slight sales pitch.
Here we go. It's really cool. It's a...
Look at that. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, this is a red dot wear thermos that designed by Kirsten, I guess.
It's actually, it's right? a clean canteen, very high quality.
It's pretty sweet. That really you look great. You had to bring this up, Andrew. Why did you have to do that?
Anyway, it's really nice and keeps you hydrated.
Wait, put it next to the 9280. Which one's bigger?
They're
actually pretty close. They're very close.
It's like the same
it's a little
size,
lighter.
Yeah.
The glass will do it. All right, so that was, okay. What else you got for us, Jose?
All right, real question. How do TL SL lenses compare when using a CL TL body or SL body?
What?
Say that one more time. Got a lot of letters in there.
How do TL SL lenses compare when using CL TL body or SL body?
Well, if you mount a TL lens onto an SL or an SL2, it's cropped to APS-C.
Mm-hmm.
10 megapixels on the SL, 20 megapixels on the SL2. If you mount an SL lens on a CL, it's the same, full frame, 24 megapixels.
No crop.
There's no crop factor at all. The lens itself is cropped in the sense that 90 SL mounted on a CL becomes a 135 on the CL because this is not full frame. Now, personally, I use CL lenses on the SL2 all the time because for me, 20 megapixels is more than adequate for most of the stuff that I'm doing for fun. Social media, small prints, whatever. It's very acceptable. You still have autofocus, image stabilization, electronic aperture control. Say that 10 times fast.
Yep.
All the same benefits you have with the CL lens on the CL plus stabilization, it's extremely usable.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Jeff, if you're watching this, please comment because you have like three CL lenses on your SL2. So it's actually probably the most underrated or underappreciated setup.
You got one right in front of you.
In the Leica ecosystem. So this is an SL2 with the 60 Apo Macro TL, one of the nicest lenses in the TL lineup.
Mm-hmm.
This combination sits on my desk every single day. If you've ever asked me for photos of something, like a product that we're selling or some detail, I take it with this. We'll talk about the macro setup later, but my point being is this lens is so good on the SL2 that it lives on the SL2 for me pretty much all the time. It's light, it's very easy to handle. It's like, it doesn't really feel like much at all. And again, still autofocus, still electronic aperture control, plus you get the stabilization. So I think if you've got an SL2 and you're looking to augment your lens lineup a little bit, and you know you're gonna be in situations where you may not need the full 47 megs or may not want it, don't hesitate to grab one or two TL lenses. They're plentiful, new, plentiful pre-owned, comparatively inexpensive.
True.
To
true.
An SL native lens. I mean, if you put, where's the 18? I'm sure I've showed this before, but if you put the 18 Elmaret TL on the SL2, this lens is 80 grams. I mean, it weighs basically the same as a body cap. You've got a 20 megapixel.
It's a very high quality body cap.
Seriously, you got a 20 megapixel, right? 20 megapixel, 28 millimeter, 2.8 autofocus camera. If you had a
like M-sized.
If you had a big enough pocket, you could definitely stick this in there. Maybe like a coat pocket, a trench coat pocket. I mean, this is fun. And of course, again, it's autofocus. This is no performance compromises. It works very well. It's a 2.8. So if you like a 28 Elmaret on an M, this is like the SL version of that. So, you know, don't discredit these little guys. These are pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I'm sure we'll talk more about that as we go. So,
well, and I want to interject this.
Yes.
So a lot of the technology and a lot of the new design methods that Leica came up with for lenses like the Apo Summicron SLs originated with lenses like that 60 Apo Macro TL. They redefined their design goals and their design specs to be a lot sharper and a lot higher resolving. First of all, because they knew they were going to have smaller sensors with higher resolution, and they needed to resolve a lot more detail. But also, they knew that that would be the basis. The L-mount, if you read my coverage, the L-mount was always intended to be a multi-format lens mount. So they always had this idea that it would be a full-frame mount, and they were just starting out with the APS style. And what's fascinating is, you know, people really underrate these TL lenses, but optically, they're in the same league as the SL lenses for like half the price.
Yeah, I mean, I think that 35 and 60 are our two favorites.
Yeah, for sure.
I got to give a top tip, another Josh top tip, because you know I love weird accessories. If you have a this is fun. If you have a 35-1.4 CL or TL or 60 macro TL. One of these two. These both are a 60 millimeter E60 front, or even the 55 to 135. Now, the manufacturer of the Thumbs Up Match Technical makes this rubber cap for the Q and the Q2. We've definitely talked about it before. They're super popular. It's a nice silicone rubber cap. But this also, and Bev, if you're watching, thank you for figuring this out. This also fits on any of the E60 TL lenses. So if you have a 35-1.4 and you don't want to use the regular plastic cap, or you have a Q with you, this actually fits quite nicely. It also works. Nice. I'll just show on the 55 to 135 here, like so.
Nice.
So, and then this normally has a lanyard on it, which I've removed because it doesn't do me any good on the TL lenses. But if you have a 35-1.4 TL, 60 macro TL, or a 55 to 135 TL, I would definitely recommend getting one or more of these rubber caps because They're way more secure and protective than the native Leica caps. They're actually cheaper to buy than Leica replacement caps. So you can take your originals and stick them in the box. And they'll do a better job keeping dust and debris. And if you're knocking around the bag, they won't pop off like those pinch caps will. So this is the Match Technical LCSR01QQ2 rubber cap. That's not a very sexy name, but
not very
it works
much so.
Beautifully on any of these 60 millimeter filter size TL lenses. So that's a little
nice
secret tip for everybody watching who may be looking for an alternative to their caps.
Got to give you the pro tips.
That's right. Very important. And it's pretty satisfying tips. To put it on. Right. What else we got?
Jose?
Yeah, we have a quick one here. What is the ratio on the SL2 if you switch to APS-C?
The same.
Yeah. 3:2.
Yeah. Same ratio, just less resolution cropped in, but it doesn't.
Yeah, I think they were asking because they said 1.5, so I think they were asking.
The crop factor is 1.5x.
Yes, yeah, 50%, yeah, 1.5, yeah.
So, in other words, a 50 millimeter would be a 75.
Yeah.
A 100 would be a 150.
I think they got it.
Yeah. Math. Hey, listen, yeah. Math.
Well, which we're clearly not good at, so.
Math is hard.
It is hard. Let's go shopping. That's an Amy thing. Okay.
I know what it is.
What else we got?
How would you assess the optical quality or rendering difference between the 35 Apo SL and the 35M Summicron on the SL2?
Dramatically different.
Yeah.
I mean, the SL lens is better in every measure.
In every measure, yeah.
I mean, I mean, if I already had a 35 Cron M lens, I'd put it on the SL2. But if I didn't, I wouldn't buy one. I mean, obviously budget dependent, but I wouldn't buy one. I would buy a 35 SL because it's sharper, less distortion, cleaner bokeh, more modern look.
I mean, quite simply, better. It's the best 35 that ever made.
Yeah, and autofocus and weather seal period. And all those other benefits. So
that being said,
yes.
That being said, if let's say you had a 35 Summicron M lens and you have a full M system and you're looking to kind of stretch into an SL or a CL system, I think the M lenses can really augment. Let's say, maybe my suggestion would be get a 24-90 for the SL and have fun with the 35 Cron, because then you're getting a very different look than you're gonna get with the 24-90 or with the 35 F2 SL lens. And that way you have some variety. You still have lenses for your M kit, and you can have some crossover and do some experimentation and get a different look.
There you go.
I mean, it's all about choices.
Have fun, right? I mean, we love to talk about like the best this, the best that, but that's doesn't really mean anything if that's not what you want.
No.
Like, it's, you know, we use old vintage wild stuff all the time. We don't just take, oh, this is the best, let's use it. I mean, David and I are constantly experimenting with different lenses, and
that's where the fun is.
Yeah, that's seriously, that's the beauty of SL, SL2, CL, TL, is because you have these adapters.
Yeah.
You have access to, as David said earlier, something like 300 or more different lenses you can from Leica's own product portfolio over the past 70 odd years.
I mean, look, you could use a 50-year-old M lens on an SL2, and it's going to give it such a different look, you know. And maybe you don't want that biting perfection that is the SL glass. Maybe you want something with character, or you want it to look more vintage. So you don't have to use a vintage camera with that vintage lens. You can use that vintage lens with all the features that come with the new camera.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pretty neat.
It's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, you could even shoot video with a 50-year-old M lens and get a vintage movie look. So it's all about choices. And I am really glad when Leica created the L-mount, they did that from the start.
Ritu, if you buy a new 50-1-4, I will give you a thermos for free. How's that? From me. Ritu's on there just talking about...
He says he got the thermos.
No, he wants to buy a used 50 Summilux SL, which is hard to find. But I'm saying, Ritu, don't just get a new one. We got them. And I will give you a thermos free of charge. I'll even drink out of it for you ahead of time to make sure it doesn't have any funny taste or anything. So, should we talk about macro? Because I think people are dying.
How many more? Do we have any more lingering questions here from...
Yeah, we have some.
Well, do you have any quick answer ones?
Yeah, let's do...
Fire off a few. Because we should do macro at like 9-ish.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's like a whole...
It's a whole thing.
It's a whole thing.
Any advice on manually focusing an L-mount lens?
Oh, we should talk about this. We were talking about this.
My advice is probably not to. It's fine. You know, I do do it for landscape shooting. As I mentioned earlier.
Yeah, you should show that.
Yeah, let me.
With an SL.
Yeah.
Let me pop on.
1635.
There.
Let's do that.
You keep talking about it.
Yeah, so this is going to be a scenario I use quite a lot. It's the exact setup. So I really love the 1635. It's just an awesome landscape lens, a little smaller than the 2490, a fair amount lighter, I think, or at least I feel it is. Okay, so we're going to take a look at that and give me a close up. Okay.
There you go.
So you guys see the display screen right here.
Careful. There
okay.
You go. Got it.
And you can see that it's at 5.6. So now normally, let's say I'm in a, remember I talked about diffraction, but I do think that, you know, F10, I'm willing to stretch, or F9. Let's say F9.
Raise it up a little bit so it's in the center of the frame. There you go.
Well, I want to also show the lens.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so let's dial this to 16 millimeter. So I'm at 16 millimeter F9, as you can see there. And if I half press, and this is going to be really interesting to see. Okay, now as I half press the shutter.
Well, what autofocus mode are you in? This is important.
Well, right now it's in manual.
Well, that's what I mean. This only works.
Right. You see how it's not focusing right now. It's just activating right here. If I wanted to activate autofocus, I would use the back button.
Well, what I'm saying is, sorry to
which
interrupt,
I just did.
But this is important because if the focus mode is not set to MF,
yep,
you won't see what David is showing you on the top screen.
Yeah, let me change it so you can see what that is.
Just want to make there, just before you get really into this, just want to make really clear.
Yep. So if I switch this to autofocus, which I just did on the back.
Yeah.
Okay.
AFS.
Okay, now it's in AFS, and you'll notice I half press the shutter. Nothing's happening except the fact that the camera's focusing.
Yeah.
But nothing is going on in the top display.
Yeah.
Okay, it's staying exactly as it was. If I go back to the menu and I switch it to manual focus,
MF.
All the way over here.
Yep, there we go.
Okay. MF. There you go. So it's, you can see it's highlighted in red right there. MF. Okay, we go to the top again. And now you'll notice on the display right at the bottom, okay, it says three lines. And since you may or may not see that, I'm going to read them off. So we've got back, focus, and front. There we go. And as, I did not mean to take a picture. And as we turn the lens, you'll notice that those numbers, I'm trying to not get a reflection.
You want me to turn the lens for you? Or?
See there? Okay, now it's moving. All those numbers are moving in play. So the key is I'm trying to turn the lens, kind of maintain a consistent speed. And what I'm going to do to get hyperfocal distance when I'm focusing, I'm going to turn this till it hits infinity, which I think I did. Nope, not yet. I'm just taking a quick look. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, there you go.
It's hard to see both sides of this. Okay. And
you're at infinity.
Yeah, I'm at infinity. Okay, I'm at infinity, and you can see that I've got infinity down to 1.7 meters as my, so one infinity is my back, and my front is 1.7 meters. That means that everything from, and that was actually at 21. Let me go, sorry, I moved the lens. Okay, just gonna do it, tweak it one more time here. There we go. Okay, so everything now from 1.4 meters.
You had it so good.
I had it so good. 1.4 meters to infinity, and that's at F8, which is actually gonna be even sharper. So if I can get away with that, that's going to allow me, without having to refocus every time, because I'm in MF mode, I just set up, compose, move around my composition, keep shooting. Because I'm in manual focus, as I press the shutter button, it's not refocusing the lens every time.
Let me just kind of rehash what David was showing you, just to get it,
to
reiterate. So essentially, if you look at an M lens, you do the old school scale focusing where, okay, at F8, I put my markers between 6 feet and infinity. That's what this is. This is the SL, since it knows the focus point and it knows the depth of field and it knows the aperture because it's a native lens for the SL system, it can calculate how much depth of field you have based on the point you've focused on, where the depth of field starts and where the depth of field ends.
Yep.
You can use that to your advantage for any kind of photography, generally tripod mounted or something static, to be very precise about what is in focus, what is not in focus. And also the real objective in terms of eliminating diffraction is to use the widest open aperture possible, use that depth of field scale to get as much depth of field as you can based on your scene.
Exactly.
So instead of just saying, I'm gonna stop down to 22 to get everything sharp and not worry about it, you may only need 6.3.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to dial in that scale so your infinity is in the back. So it is an extremely powerful functionality that the SL, SL2, and the S system
S007 and S3 have it too.
On that top screen when you're in MF mode to allow you a very, very clear and precise way of looking at how much depth of field you have. And you can put that in meters or feet, by the way. If it has it in meters, you can put it in feet.
I like working in meters because I feel worldly like that. And really, if you think about, 1.4 meters is, it's about 5.5 feet. So basically, if you're shooting at head level, your feet are in focus. Think about that, right? So you're shooting at anything that's at your feet or in front of your feet, in front of your tripod, all the way to infinity is gonna be completely sharp at F8 at 16 millimeter on this camera. Now, if I used autofocus or I used manual focus and I manually focused all the way to infinity, I'm gonna be giving up all that depth of field that's going forward. Because if you looked, I'm actually, it changed, I'm not focusing at infinity. What I'm actually focusing at is 4 meters. You would never think to focus at 4 meters to shoot something at infinity. But the camera knows because it has all those depth of field tables in it and it's totally dynamic. And that allows you to maximize that without having to shop down to, you know, F16, F22 or whatever. So you're gonna, as far as manual focusing goes, I think it's, I mean, that really, you have to use manual focusing for this kind of hyperfocal function, and I use it all the time. But I would not attempt to do manual focusing for a fast-moving subject like a child or a dog or whatever, because I think that would be an exercise in frustration. If you really wanted to use manual focus with the SL, you know, I might recommend using an M lens at that point because
or an R lens
that are designed specifically for manual focus and have much shorter throws and are more linear in terms of their behavior. So
there you go.
Hopefully that answered your question.
Yeah. If you've never tried this functionality on your SL2 SL before, just sit at home and
play with
put
it.
The camera on a table and play with it and experiment and see what you can do with it. It's actually.
It works better at wider focal lengths.
Yeah. It is definitely an underutilized functionality on the SL and the SL2. So, should we talk about macro yet?
And David says, yes, you are correct. In autofocus mode, if you half press the shutter button and rotate the focus ring at the same time, that actually functions as a manual focus override and you'll get that scale. But keep in mind, when you take a picture and you press the shutter release, that is also activating and resetting your focus for the next frame. So my suggestion, if you want to use that hyperfocal, make sure that you're in manual focus so you don't have to reset it every single time you take a picture.
Yeah.
The idea is to preset the focus and then take your concentration and put it to composition, exposure, and, you know, keeping an eye on the moment.
And if you want to learn more about how to use back button focus, I'll refer you back to our SL, one of our two SL videos, I forget which one, but it's in one of them where we talk about how to actually set up and use back button focus. So let's keep going.
All right.
Should we do it?
Jose, are we almost caught up?
No, we have 1,000 questions.
Yeah, we have a lot of questions.
we're never gonna get to them all. Well, at least not on air, but if you obviously leave a comment or just email info@leicastarmiami, we'll answer any question you have about.
This is a quick one.
Yeah, so what's which one?
This is a really easy answer.
Which one should I ask? I'll do it.
Kenny.
Kenny says, or asks, will a full frame, your hands are blocking. Will a,
sorry.
Will a full frame lens look better than a crop lens of the same actual focal length on a crop sensor? Smaller diameter elements of a crop lens equals more aberrations at a given distance from the center? Question mark.
No. You have, I guess conventional wisdom in the early days of digital when, let's say, other manufacturers had digital SLRs, they often had 1.5 or 1.6x crops. They didn't have any full frame options. Full frame wasn't a thing until, like, what year was it?
The,
I don't know.
The 14N was the first one.
The 14N was two sensors glued together. That doesn't count.
Fine, the 1DS.
Or like the 1DS, yeah. The 5D, maybe the 5D was the first commercially viable.
Yeah, we're getting off topic.
Anyway, but that was like 2008 or something. Mm-hmm. So, so basically, you always took the center of the frame, and it hid a lot of the evils of some of those early lenses that were pre-digital. The great thing is the L-mount, both the TL lenses, the SL lenses, were all designed specifically for performance on digital mirrorless cameras. So they are as good full frame as they are in APS mode because they're high enough resolving power to be able to resolve a higher megapixel internal shot at APS. And they're also, you know, excellent into the corners to be able to function on full frame at high resolution. So really, I would say no with Leica L-mount lenses because it's not going to make a difference. They're all designed to perform excellently within those design envelopes.
Right. If you have a CL, I would say, unless you're planning on getting an SL in the future, if you want a 35 autofocus lens, get a 35-1.4 CL lens. It's not like the SL 35 APO will
perform better
because it's full frame. It's going to look different. It's also going to be twice the price and twice the size. But,
and heavy,
So... the native lenses are excellent. So many questions. I'm really glad everybody's participating.
And Dwayne asked, does the hyperfocus trick work with the CL2? I'm speaking of hyperfocus when using a 50 millimeter Summilux or 35 millimeter. And that's an easy one?
No. The hyperfocal scale that David was showing you is only on the SL2 and S007 and S3 using the native system lenses.
So it's kind of a pro feature, you will.
Yeah.
Sorry.
What's next?
I have one here from DTR. How does the Leica theme bar M look on the SL2?
I told you somebody would ask about it. Oh, I was going to bring it. And he was like, don't bring the theme bar.
Well, you can rewind about 5 minutes when I said you can use a super vintage-y lens on
so
the modern camera. Take that answer and apply it here.
The theme bar is so much fun on the SL2.
It's all swirly
it's
and
wild,
crazy.
But it's... unlike using on an M, unless you're using a VisaFlex, you can see the thembariness in real time, decide whether or not to use the filter. It's awesome. And because the SL2 is so high res and so demanding, it actually takes advantage even more so of all the inherent design flaws or optical flaws from using a lens designed in the, I don't know, 30s.
Yeah.
Whatever. Thembar is fun. It's not an everyday lens. We talked about it a bit on the telephoto lens live stream, but... it's black paint. It's made out of brass. Super cool. I don't know. It has a detentless aperture ring. I mean, I don't know. What more can you want out of life?
Does the look work on video?
Does what?
Does the look work on video?
A fan bar for video? Probably.
Sure. Yeah.
Well.
Why not?
If you want to get real artsy. Yeah.
And in fact, if you want to avoid some of the craziest outside edges, you know, if you're using an SL2, you can either use full frame for 4K or you can use the center crop mode.
Hmm.
They're both 4K. They're just different formats, super 35 or full frame. And that might be a little more tame and under control unless you really want that crazy swirliness on the
There's nothing else that looks like it, and you're never going to get there in post, at least not without working yourself to death. So if you want to have some fun, Thambar, do it.
Yeah,
this
is an easy one. I'm just going to ask you because you'll be able to say. Kenny asks, are there modulation transfer charts for other people probably know those as MTF charts for Leica L lenses?
Yes, if you go to Leica Camera's website and you go to support, downloads, and then you can filter by system.
Mm-hmm. Technical information.
Right, you just look for the technical information on the SL lenses and each has a really nicely made PDF. Full specs, description, MTF charts,
distortion
charts,
yep.
Everything. Really, really comprehensive. So,
and if you don't want to search there, you can go on red.forum.com, search for the lens you want because I'm pretty sure, or just scroll down the, or just scroll down to the description.
Yeah.
Because I put all the MTF charts in all the lens announcements.
Yeah, there you go. So yes, that's very easily accessible, totally free. So good question.
All right.
I think it's micro time.
Yay! I mean, I don't know why I'm cheering. It's like an exhausting subject. So, The question is...
Someone says, we went out of focus?
I mean, that's just the makeup I'm wearing right now. It's this new line, out of focus. there is no native SL full frame macro solution. Doesn't exist, right?
Yet.
Currently. We don't know if there will be. Leica has not announced plans to make one. So what does that mean? Well, that means if you want to shoot macro with the SL or the SL2, you have to use something else. Thankfully, within Leica's family of lenses, you have a number of options. We have talked about them piecemeal here and there. Hopefully, right now, David and I can sort of summarize what the options are. So why don't...
I'll demonstrate while you talk about it.
So the first method, and the method I use the most, is the 60 macro TL on the SL or the SL2. It's the only macro lens Leica has ever made that's one-to-one, meaning life size. You can get your subject 6 centimeters from the front element. Extremely, extremely close. I use this every day for product photography, a lot of my sort of in-house type of work that I need to do. So this setup is awesome.
It's very lightweight.
It's not full frame, right? It's 20 megapixels, which for me is fine for a lot of the things I do, but it's autofocus and all that other goodness. So
keep in mind,
yes.
I'm just gonna do this real quick. But keep in mind.
Can you hold up something?
Yeah, I just wanna like have something to focus on. That's your face.
What are you
there
doing?
We go, I got it there.
Okay.
Okay, so keep in mind when you're looking at the back of the screen, there we go.
It's getting heavy.
You don't know that it's cropped. There's no indication that it's cropped because the preview image fills up your entire field of view either in the viewfinder, in the EVF, or on the rear screen.
It's not like the Q that has the crop lines. It just expands the whole view, so it's uninterrupted, which is pretty nice.
So
that's the first solution.
So it's actually pretty nice.
60 macro TL. Benefits are... What?
But what are you giving up on this?
So the pros, autofocus, one-to-one, lightweight, no adapters needed. Again, lightweight. Cons,
very, very light.
Not full frame, meaning you get a 20 megapixel image no matter how badly you want more. That's really the only con in this case.
And you get image stabilization.
Well, that's a pro. Well, any lens you mount on the SL2, you get stabilization. Mm-hmm. So, first solution.
Yep.
Second solution, the Leica S120 macro, which is a 1:2, not a 1:1. Again, the 60 is the only 1:1. But like a S120 macro, using the S adapter L, which I have caps on, I'm sorry.
I want to make sure to turn that off.
Yes.
Yep. Safety tip, if you are using the S adapter on the SL or SL2, always make sure to turn the camera off.
Yes.
When you are mounting or dismounting the S adapter.
Yes.
We can't tell you why.
We don't know, but you're supposed to do it.
But always do it.
So, okay. 120 macro, S lens, S adapter L on the SL2. Pros, autofocus.
You can hear it, yeah.
Electronic aperture control, weather sealing. This is the only full frame weather sealed macro solution that you have on the SL2 because the TL lenses are not weather sealed. Focus is a little slow, but of course your macro, you're probably doing manual focus anyway.
You can see you can see just the vast focus throw on this lens.
The main reason to use this setup is because it's full frame, because you'll get the full 47 megapixels, which you won't get if you use a 60 macro TL.
I think I should also mention that another reason, another reason is the 120 is not just one of my favorite S lenses, because it is, it is one of my favorite lenses that Leica has ever made. Mm. This lens is just flat out stunning.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ridiculously sharp, but like creamy and buttery and gorgeous color.
You have a review of this from the S2 days, don't you?
Yes.
It still holds up in terms of those lenses.
But I have more modern samples on my S lens roundup that I just did this year.
Perfect.
And you can see this lens, oh my gosh, it is like... It's so sharp, but it's great for portraits because it doesn't have this kind of artificial sharpness. It's just crisp, but pleasing and smooth and incredible.
All right, so those are the two autofocus Leica solutions. 60 macro TL, 120 macro S lens, right? So now we get on to manual focus.
Oh, and Christian is correct. And you can see, even though I'm in autofocus here, it is always overridable, and it is a mechanical manual focus system. All of the S lenses actually are dual focus systems. They have full autofocus gearing and full manual focus gearing and clutchless design. You can override at any time. So for manual focus feel, the S lenses are gonna always be better than the SL lenses.
Yes, okay, let's keep going.
So yes, thank you for the comment.
So, talked about the two autofocus solutions. Now we also have a couple of manual focus solutions. We're gonna start with R lenses. Leica has made, well, a number of them. The two most well-known and usable macro R lenses are the 60 and the 100. So, macro L-mount R 60 millimeter, Apo macro L-mount R 100 millimeter. Mm-hmm. Two excellent R system lenses for the SL that you use with the R adapter L. Manual focus, there we go. So this is the 100, this is the 60. The 100 is the superior in terms of quality. The 60 is half the price and half the size. They're both 1:2. Neither of them are 1:1. Again, the 60 macro TL is the only 1:1 solution. Now, we can mount, let's try the 100 onto the R adapter L. Your red dot is missing. Oh, no, it's not. It's right here. I'm judging you too fast.
Don't judge me.
So this is the 100 macro Apo, or 100 Apo macro L-mount R 2.8 R adapter L, which now David will mount onto the SL2.
And when this lens came out in 1997?
Something like that.
Yeah, I remember Popular Photography. I actually remember that issue where they reviewed this lens with the R8 when it also came out at the same time. And they said this was the sharpest 35 millimeter lens they had ever tested in their lab.
Not 35 millimeter focal length. He means no, 35 millimeter system.
Yeah. Format, yeah.
And so,
yeah, super good.
Pros, full frame.
Compact.
Compact-ish, especially if you go with the 60.
This is pretty compact.
An extremely, extremely precise manual focus during that. Is it three full turns?
270 degrees, yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts.
You can get a close-up on that and see.
Very sharp. Not that hard to find pre-owned.
Got a nice little slide-out shade, too.
Yeah, built really well, right? That's the pros. Cons, you need an adapter, which is an extra thing to buy.
It's also nice, I should point out, that these adapters, the S adapter and the R adapter are really nice. They have a little tripod foot built into the adapter, which is super nice.
Okay, so what did I say? So pros, full frame, unique rendering, easy to find, relatively affordable compared to the S lens. Cons?
It's very sharp.
Cons, manual focus, manual aperture, and it's a little bit older, so it's not going to give you the same level of sharpness as the 60 macro TL or the 120 macro S, but a different look, for sure. And, you know, fun. And good for portraits. I know, Jim, if you're watching this, you use a lens on your SL2 for portraits, and you told me you liked it, so hopefully that's still the case. Let's pop on the old 60. Oh, we almost had the first drop of the episode.
No drops. Missed it. No dropsies today.
So again, the same pros and cons as the 100. Pros meaning it is full frame. That's probably the biggest pro compared to the 60 macro.
Really compact.
TO. Light, compact. These are like $1,000 if you could find them. This is a version 2. That's the one you want.
Long focus throw again.
Yeah.
So not this as is long as the 100 though.
60 macro L-mount R. So again, R adapter L plus either the 60 macro or the 100 macro is another full frame solution.
Although I would add, because these are my lenses here, the 60 is. Remember I was saying with the SL lenses you don't have to stop down for maximum sharpness. Well, in 60 you kind of do. So at 2.8. It's nice. It gives a really kind of dreamy look to it. Definitely softer, really nice for flower photography. I actually like that. And you get a lot of natural vignetting and fall off to the edges. Not as precise and modern a design as the 100 or anywhere near the 120. So this is more of a classic design from the 1970s, I think. And but when you stop it down to, say, 5.6 or f8, it is really sharp across the whole frame. But I often like to use it around 2.8, f4, because I really like the look.
Sandy, you are correct. Leica has made macro adapters for the 60 and the L-Pro for the 100, which do give you 1:1.
You do. So this lens, too, has a 1:1.
The macro adapter.
Yeah.
So that goes behind the lens. The L-Pro grows in front of the 100. So pros to that, they do get you to 1:1. The L-Pro does reduce quality a little bit. They're also really hard to find. So it's like
much harder than the lenses.
It's not the most practical solution just because they are rare. But yes, that totally works. And there is an adapter that exists that we can sometimes get that allows you to mount the L Pro R for the 100 macro onto the 120S macro to get full frame.
I think we showed that in our S episode.
Yeah, we wanted to. I didn't actually have the L Pro.
Oh, you didn't get it?
But we're talking about a hard to get adapter and an even harder to get L Pro, so it's not practical.
Right.
You're better off just getting a 60 macro TL or whatever if you want one to one. It's not worth all the trouble. Okay. So
I also want to mention one other thing before we move off of our lenses, which is kind of interesting. You may have caught kind of a flash of it, and Jose, if you get a close up here, on the back of some R lenses, you see these electronic contacts there. You can see the copper contacts or brass or whatever. I think they're copper. Copper contacts. And then here you'll see the copper contacts that correspond to the lens. And if I take this off the body, you can see on the back side of the adapter the same copper contacts. And then, of course, the camera has that. You know, this is clearly something you can see on modern SL lenses. We also have electronic contacts. This is what gives communication between the camera.
This is the reason the R adapter L is so expensive.
Yeah.
Because it passes that ROM contact information through to the body.
So in your EXIF data, in your camera file, it will know if this is a ROM lens, it will know, one, that you're using the R adapter L and that you're using this lens on the R adapter L, and that'll embed in your metadata.
Yeah, sweet.
Which is really nice because that also means that if you have automatic lens corrections enabled in Lightroom, they'll apply to your files automatically.
So two quick things. Number one, Andy, we did talk about the FAMR. Rewind or watch later.
About 15 minutes ago.
Yeah. Version 2 60 macro, the easiest way is that the version 1 has like little metal posts on the front, around the front ring, like where the filter would go. Version 2 doesn't, but.
This is a version 2.
That's a version 2, the one you want. Now, the last solution within the Leica ecosystem for macro photography on the SL is the 90 macro Elmar M, a lens that we love to death, combined with the macro adapter M. So, pop this on like so, extend the lens out. There we go. And we also, of course, need the M adapter L. I have the silver one because I'm cool like that. We can go a step further if we want, and we've done this before on the show, is we use the L Pro 52. This is Leica's latest macro solution. This will thread. I'm going to show the close-up here. Here we go. I have your 39mm thread adapter on here. I'm going to pop this on. There we go. So now I have M adapter L, macro adapter M, macro Elmar M 90mm version 2, L Pro 52 with a step up ring. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 components.
But it's still really
not
small.
It's really not that big. And when you collapse it, it's quite small. And this will give us the ideal M solution. I'm going to give this to David now. He's beating questions. There we go.
Ooh.
Full frame. So the pros, full frame. Extraordinarily sharp. The 90 macro Elmar M is one of the sharpest lenses they make.
It's a sleeper right here.
Full frame, extremely sharp, compact, and all of these components are available new or pre-owned. My point being is, unlike the L Pro and some of the R stuff, all of this is relatively easy to find.
And it looks like you have a science experiment.
Also true.
You know, on the front of your camera. So.
Yes, if James is watching this, James in New York, if you're watching this, you can comment because you do some awesome watch photography with this type of setup. So you don't need to have the L Pro on there. You can get 1-to-1 without it.
Mm-hmm.
The L Pro just makes it like
more than 1-to-1.
3-to-1. I mean, it's insane.
Right. So you've crossed the line then.
Yeah.
This is actually not just macro. This is micro.
Yes. Yeah. So what was I going to say? Right. So the 90 macro has another cool functionality with the SL2 and with the M's as well. When you want to get closer, you say, well, I use a macro lens or a macro adapter. The problem traditionally is with adapters, I mean, with extension tubes or L Pros, it's kind of like you can get sort of close or really close.
Mm-hmm.
If you want something in the middle, you actually have the ability with specifically the 90 macro and the macro adapter M to use a combination of three variables, three adjustments to get the complete distance from infinity to minimum without any breaks. because you have the adjustability. Can we get a close-up on this, Jose? Thank you. You have the adjustability of the macro adapter itself, like so.
It's an basically, this is a variable length extension tube.
Yes. You have the focus ring on the lens itself, and you have the collapsible section of the lens, which you can move at almost like its own version of an extension tube. Mm-hmm. So these three controls give you from absolute minimum to infinity without having to change anything on.
Yeah, so absolute minimum would be extended and then at minimum distance.
Yes.
Which is, yeah.
You can't get infinity with the L Pro. I should probably mention that.
Ever, right.
Right.
Not
so
with this.
Forget the L Pros on there. So you can go from infinity to 1-to-1 with that setup without the L Pro on there, which is amazing. And that works on an M camera. You just need to use live.
Yeah. So right now, I've removed the micro, let's call it the micro adapter. I've removed that.
The L Pro, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just for naming. Good.
Are we back?
I think so. All right. We're back.
Are we back? Somebody say something if we're back. Somebody type something that says we're back. Anyone?
Here.
We're begging you. Are we?
All right, guys. Sorry about that.
So what happened was a meteor
just crashed right through the window.
Shot through the studio.
Amazing.
I dove in front. You didn't see this, but I dove in front of it, and I saved all the equipment. I'm missing both of my legs right now. Thankfully, you can't see them anyway, so I'm totally fine.
Yeah.
Sorry, everybody. I had a little technical glitch there. Everybody see us?
Yes.
So let's just get back into it. So we talked about
The
macro solutions. I was going to sum up. We're going to move on because we did it. 60 macro TL, 120 macro S, 100 APO macro R, 60 macro R, 90 macro M. Those are the Leica macro solutions available in the L mount. This will work on, well, not the S lens, but the other lenses. Works on the CL, TL2, SL, SL2. S adapter L only works on the SL and the SL2. I should mention that. All the other options will work on the CL or the TL2. Of course, with those cameras, you have the 60 macro TL as native, so you really have no reason to use anything else unless you own it already and want to have some fun.
Whew. We got macro out of the way.
So I guess we call it.
It only took a meteor, though.
An intermission, meteor-related intermission.
Oh, we should have the music.
Was the dog hurt?
The dog is fine. He's asleep.
Yeah.
Who cares about us? The dog is all that matters. I agree with that. Whoever said that, we're friends. All right, so we still have time. We're doing great. Julie, I think you see us hopefully now. Thank you for bearing with us.
Thank you for your concern, guys. We're
good. All right, let's carry on. We talked about any questions about the macro setup. I know we had a bit of a break, so if there's questions about macro, let me see.
I'm just checking up on the things.
Would switching the SL2 to APS-C be any different than cropping in post? Nope, it's exactly the same. The only difference is you can see the crop in real time.
Magnified view.
That's the only reason. And the full frame is still there in the raw. So
kind of like when you crop on the Q2, right? Yeah. It's just allowing you to preview it that way, but you still are capturing the full file.
Good question, though. Any other macro questions, or can we move on past that?
There were, before we cut out here.
Hey, James, say you're welcome to chat again. James has awesome work, plus he shoots cool watches. So.
Nice.
Waitlisted on Instagram. You should
check
him out.
Thanks for the shout out.
Now he has an M10R because he's cool like that.
All right. So there was a question about. Subhash wants to know if we tested the 60R versus the 100, aside from focal length, how much better is the 100? Well, considering that I own both of those lenses and I've used them pretty extensively over the last
forever
15 years, the 100 is a lot better. But that's not to say that the 60 doesn't have its place, because the 60 finds its way into my bag more often than the 100. I know that the 100 is better in every measurable way, but it's half the weight, half the size, and it gives kind of a unique look if I use it wide open, and I still get it really bitingly sharp if I stop it down. So I tend to use the 60 even though it's not as good, because it's not always about using what is the absolute best, asterisk, whatever.
Which we talked about earlier.
It's using what's fun.
Of course, David has both, so he doesn't have to choose.
Yeah.
He could bring both if he wants.
There you go.
I mean, you know, the cost of both is probably the same as buying a 60 macro TL new, so that's one more.
But I've had them for so long.
Right, exactly. Yeah. You paid for fractions of what
they're worth. I paid like $5 for that 60. Yeah. Maybe seven.
Did we miss anything? Other questions? I just want to make sure we didn't mess anyone's question.
Jack asked, best telephoto lens options for greater than 280 millimeter, which we covered if you want to go back in the video.
Yeah.
We talked about some of the R lens options.
Yeah. And everything else.
Let's see. What else? A pair of L Pros that I use with 50 Summicron and R adapter.
Nice. Okay.
We did talk about the Thambar.
I think we covered.
I think we got it.
Okay. And we still have questions to answer from our. What do we get?
This is an interesting question.
Okay. Go ahead and ask us so you can answer.
Yeah, well, I'll ask you. Jim wants to know if you use the APS-C lens, a TL or CL lens, on the SL2, do you also have to apply the crop factor to aperture or only for focal length?
Well, not to aperture in the sense of the exposure, but in terms of the other field, yes. So a 35-1.4, you can look at it this way. So it's the same amount of depth of field factor as there is crop factor. So it's half as much or 50% as much depth of field.
But at the same distance.
Right. So it's not exactly the same as focal length in terms of like it's not as prevalent.
No.
But it is a variable that you have to consider. That was kind of a rambling answer, but.
No, that's fine. Yeah. That's fine. All right. I don't have a problem answering that last one.
It's not taboo to ask about the Sigma lenses because we certainly recognize the benefit of the ML Alliance. But as I said earlier, we haven't shot any of them, any Sigma, any Panasonic. You know, that's cool and we're interested, but
there's so many options here.
We're Leica people. That's what we do. That's what you come to watch us for. So I would say I'm always interested in learning about new stuff, but the reality is for us, our world is Leica. We try to learn as much as we can about it. Do as much testing as we can, and recognizing that there are other options, that's awesome, but just don't ask me about it because I have no idea.
Yeah. And you know, we may do a roundup article to see if we can get our hands on a bunch of the Sigma glass and you know, do some comparisons and see what kind of a difference there
eventually.
Is.
You know, but again, David and I have been shooting with the L-mount since day one within Leica's ecosystem. We would have to start from scratch. You know, we want to make sure if we're going to put out that kind of content, it's relevant and, you know, done right.
And then we know what we're talking about.
Yeah, right. We're nerds like that. So good question. No, that's totally fine.
And then, the close-up lens that we attached on the front of the 90 macro, this one.
That is the L Pro 52, which is made by Leica. It's available new. It is basically a magnifying glass. It will fit on any M lens with a thread size of 52 millimeters or smaller. It comes with adapters for 46 and 49, and you can buy all the ones from third parties, step-down rings, to adapt it to any M lens or other manufacturer's lens. I mean, it works on any lens that has a 52 or smaller.
Yep.
And you can put it on the 23 TL if you want, because that has a 52 millimeter thread. David will do it right now.
I'll do it right now because I happen to have this right in front of me.
Because you have it right there.
And there it is. Yeah, so it works really well, and it's optically excellent, as one would expect from Leica glass.
Yeah. There you go.
All right.
What else we got? Jose, why don't you pull up a question from our other list?
Sure. Could you talk about the 75 and the 90 Apo SL?
Let me ask you, David. If you're going out, how do you decide if you're going to bring the 75 Apo SL or the 90 Apo SL?
I suppose it depends what other lenses I'm carrying and what I'm shooting. So let's say that I'm only going to go out with the 35 Summicron. Well, okay, that doesn't help because I probably would use either a 75 or a 90 at that point. But if I was using a 50, I probably would skip over the 75 and go to a 90. I think that 35 and 75 make for a really good pairing. 50 and 90 make for a really good pairing. I tend to skip focal lengths. That being said, I do have a full review. I do a full review on the 75 Apo SL that you can find on Red Dot Forum. And mostly I used it for portraiture. I used it to photograph my daughter around town, and it just works fantastic for that. So the thing is, some people like shooting portraiture with a 90, and some people prefer a slightly shorter focal length of the 75 where they have a little more intimacy with the subject. Because the issue with a 90 is you have to start getting pretty far away from your subject to get more than just a headshot. So I think part of that is, what do you intend it to use it for? If I was going to just use it for landscape and detail photography, you know, like close-ups of non-macro, but just isolating details that I often do in my travel photography, I prefer 90. I think if I was going to be shooting portraits with it, 75. So that's my take. But I mean, everyone's different.
If you watch our telephoto M lens video, I know this is a video about SL, but or CL. So we did talk about the choice.
Don't crush the dog.
No. The choice between 75 and 90 and kind of our logic to that. So I would go back and watch that if you have a second. Yes, the L Pro 52 does work on the Q and the Q2 in the Q2s or Q's macro modes. You can get even more macro-y. You just need a 49 to 52 step-down ring, which comes in the package that you get with the L Pro 52. So that does work. I know it's only semi-related, but I can answer that.
Yes, carry them all. Sure, why not?
What is the widest L-mount Leica lens, David?
The 16 to 35.
Right there.
Right here.
That is the widest zoom. The widest prime currently is the 35. There is no current wider prime option. There will be eventually, one day.
But I think it should be mentioned, we kind of glossed over the zooms because they're not as new as the primes. Mm. But I can't stress this enough. The three zooms, 16 to 35, 24 to 90, 90 to 280, offer, more than hyperbole, I'm saying, these are prime lens performance in zooms at every single marked focal length. And when I say prime lens performance, and this is borne out by my own testing, I don't mean like some really bad prime lens that for like $50. I mean Leica prime lens quality at every marked zoom focal length. That's like a bold statement, but it's true because I have used the snot out of these three lenses. In fact, for most of my landscape shooting, I just travel with the three zooms. And everything from 16 to 280 is covered without a gap. I am able to shoot pretty much everything with these three lenses and an SL2. My last three landscape outings were all with that kit. And there's just no getting around it. I was first flabbergasted by the 24 to 90 when it first came out with the SL601, and I could not believe the image quality that zoom produced. And then I was only more amazed when the 90 to 280 came out, and it was better than even that 180 Apo R lens.
I've seen some of David's images printed, 30 by 40 or 20 by whatever, huge, shot at 16 millimeters on the SL2. Mm, and if you look at the corners, it's mind-blowingly sharp.
So good.
I remember the first time I saw the one image, I think it was from...
With the grass and everything?
Yeah, from Colorado, yeah. Oh, I mean... Yeah. Print your stuff, people, because you're missing out. It's like, it looks better on paper than it does on the screen because it's actually closer to its native size.
Yeah.
Unless you had a ginormous monitor, that would be insane.
You'd need a really ginormous monitor.
I want to address, I know a few people have asked this in the comments, which is 75 Noctilux versus 75 SL and 90 Summilux versus 90 SL. Okay. So there's an interesting discussion to be had there. And the short version of that is, well, first of all, those two M lenses are almost triple the price of the SL lenses. However, they will give you a rendering that the SL primes will not. The SL primes are technically superior. What I mean is they're technically sharper, especially at the corners, and you know, less vignetting and less everything that some people would say is bad. But the 75 Noctilux especially, but also the 90 Summilux, give you a rendering and a look that is insane because they are as sharp in the center, or like 95% as sharp, the focus falls off extremely fast. They have the natural vignetting, and the bokeh is just insane. So I've shot all of those four lenses together side by side and to get a feel for how they work differently. Yeah. And there's something about the 75 Noctilux and the 90 Summilux, which are very similar. They share a barrel and a few other things that you cannot replicate with an SL lens. If ultimate quality is your objective, along with spending less than $10,000 and having weather sealing and autofocus, just get a 75 or a 90 and you're good. But if you want something that is mind-blowing, that is gorgeous, that looks like nothing else,
That is heavy.
75 Noctilux M.
Oh my god,
he's incredible. But I'm, you know, again, it's just 13,000 or whatever it is, and an SL 75 is 5,000. So I'm not just trying to push you towards, or anyone towards this. It is a specialized tool for a specialized task, but it is built incredibly well.
Yeah, it's, I mean, just, keep in mind that's right. F2.
Yeah.
I was going the right way. 1.4, 1.25. Yeah. I mean, this is.
Is one and a third stops faster.
Yeah, it's pretty.
But not only does it have a faster aperture, but the way it looks.
This is a very different look. Very paint, more
it's,
painterly.
It's really something else. But not a lens you'd probably use every day because of the size, the weight, and the cost.
Yeah, when a lens this compact has its own hefty, and I mean hefty, all metal machined aluminum tripod foot.
Removable tripod foot.
Yeah, but I mean that it is with its own little.
I mean,
Now,
personally, I prefer the 75 Noctilux over the 75 SL, as blasphemous as that may sound. That's mostly because I use the 90-280 a lot as my telephoto solution. When I'm going shorter or when I'm going primes, I'm using more primes that are going to give me something really unique than something. I also don't shoot a lot of portraits, but for the car stuff that I do or landscape stuff, I love the 75 Noctilux. I did a whole car show last year. Mm-hmm. With the 75 Noctilux on the SL, original SL, and that's all I had with me, or that's all I used, and it was amazing. I think I actually taped it wide open with a bit of gaffer tape because I was running around. I had a polarizer on there, and I was like golden. So, you know, it's
Subhash has a good point, and this we also have it up here, and we want to talk about that as well as a unique look. Subhash says the 75 Noctilux is very similar to the 100 millimeter S lens.
Mm.
That is true.
Mm-hmm.
We always say in the S line that the 100 is basically the Noctilux for the S.
Mm. There she is. Look at that. Super cool.
And this is a 100 millimeter. I can put the glass forward there.
There you go.
Oh, pretty, pretty, pretty. I love that look. Okay. So the 100 millimeter S lens is actually pretty light, surprisingly.
Oh, yeah.
It's one of the lightest S lenses, interestingly. And this lens, come back to me, Jose. Now, a lot of people say, oh, well, and we didn't really answer it when we touched on the 120, but I get this question a lot, so I'm going to get ahead of the comments. If I'm using a 100 millimeter S lens, which is a medium format lens, on the SL or SL2, do I have to use a crop factor? Right? We get that question
a
lot.
Sure.
No, this is a 100 millimeter lens. On the SL2, there's a crop factor when you use it on the S natively, because it's like an 80 there. Here, it actually is a 100 millimeter F2 with just buttery smooth bokeh. This is the bokeh machine for the S.
Yeah.
And it's really unique because this is a little bit longer than the 90 millimeter Apo SL, right? They're both F2, that's 90, this is 100. But this has a very different look than the 90. It's very sharp.
Not as sharp as the 90. Let's just get that
but
out of the way.
But not as sharp as the 90.
It's so different.
This is somewhere between an M Noctilux and a 90 SL.
Yeah.
It's like kind of in that middle ground of really high performing. You're not going to get any kind of like color aberrations or anything like that. It's very well corrected. But the look is much more, you know, has that warm, smooth, organic feel that you get in M lenses. So it's kind of a neat lens.
Yes. If you were going to have one S lens with an S adapter L to use on your SL or SL2, I would have a hard time choosing between the 100 or the 120. I would say if I did need the macro functionality, I'd get the 100 because it's smaller.
It's a great portrait
lens. Focuses faster. Oof, that lens is fantastic. They're hard to find, but they are incredible.
And if you would use it, you know, and I think the 75 Noctilux comes in the same discussion.
Mm.
If I was going to use these for video, or let's take that to the next level, more for cine applications, where if I'm going to basically try to do filmmaking and use people subjects, the 75 Apo might be a little too crisp for that kind of application. But the 100 S lens would be perfect, and the 75 Noctilux would be perfect. These are much more cinematic feeling than the... than the Apo Summicron SL.
Yeah.
So kind of horses for courses there. But yeah, it's...
We're spoiled for choice.
Right, and both of those have have full manual focus.
Yeah.
Again, for cine applications, having a follow focus on here will be a lot more pleasant than if you have one on a, let's say, 90
ISO. If you like to manual focus more often than not, but still want an autofocus lens, I would get 100S over the 90 SL just because the manual focus experience is so much more pleasurable. So food for thought on that.
Wow. DTR says, there's an L-mount 11mm fisheye out there. I want to check it out. I have not heard of that.
Well, again, that shows you we don't know anything about these.
That's interesting and all. That's actually one lens that I always stayed away from on the R system. I used almost every single R lens when I was shooting R as one of my main systems. I did not touch the 16mm 2.8 fisheye because I'm like, just no.
I play with it. It's wild.
Just
I mean,
no.
It's fun. Again, we like to have fun, but that's a little too much fun.
Yeah, because it's like...
It's got so much distortion. And
I guess that's the whole idea, right?
That's very true. So don't forget that S lenses are a thing, and the S adapter L is a thing. And even if you never are going to own an S camera, the S lenses on the SL2, autofocus, weather sealed, you know, aperture control, and of course now stabilized with the SL2, a viable option. Especially if you were to have, let's say, one SL native zoom, like a 24-90.
Yep.
And then instead of going with the SL primes because you want something different, grabbing one or two pre-owned S primes, maybe a 30 or 100 or 180, whatever, and having that as your prime setup with still autofocus and all those other.
Yeah, if you're looking for a tele option, like I showed that 180mm R lens, this is yet, I think, the last S lens we have on the table tonight. Mm. This is a really excellent lens. This is the 180 Apo Elmar 3.5. This is maybe one of the sharpest of the S line. And you can tell this is mine because it has some love on it. But and it's got the wrong label on the back. Remember I was telling you about labeling your lenses?
Yeah, it doesn't help when it's wrong.
they look like that. I use a little Dymo label printer and cut these in half, put them on my lens caps. But the 180 is just phenomenal. Don't let the 3.5 aperture scare you off because 3.5 is only half a stop slower than 2.8. It's fine. It's faster than f4. And this thing is so sharp and has such amazing subject background separation, even if you're 100 feet away. That's 33 meters for those in the metric system.
Yeah.
It's incredible how subjects, even that far away, stand off the background. So that 180 is pretty amazing.
Let me answer two quick questions. Mark wants to know if you can update S-lens firmware with the SL2. No, you do need an S camera for that, as far as I know.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like 99% sure.
But, I mean, there haven't been S-lens firmware updates
in a pretty
long time.
Although I will test that next week to be sure.
Make sure wherever you're getting an S lens from, a used S lens.
Right,
an S
and
S
that
lens.
Actually segues to the next question, which I'll answer your question, and I'll answer where did Albert's, right? I think it was Albert. Albert's photography.
Oh, here?
We can only speak for ourselves, or like a Storm Annie, really.
Where do you see this?
Every S lens that we sell
has
the new autofocus motor installed. It'll say that in the listing title. We will not sell any S lenses without the new autofocus motor. I can't speak for anyone else. Everyone else does their own thing.
We talked about that in our buying and selling here, too.
I have a 007 sitting on my desk, and I use that to update every S lens firmware that comes through. So if I'm selling someone an S lens, it's got the new focus motor and the latest firmware. That way, it's just I would lose sleep at night otherwise.
Yeah.
So if you are buying an S lens with the old focus motor, send it in, get the motor replaced, even if it's working fine. It takes a while, and it's like a few $100, but
it's worth it.
It's worth it. So
I'm going to ask you this question.
Yes.
Owen says, can the SL series, so I'm assuming you mean the cameras, SL601, SL2, use the S lenses CS or central shutter function?
Nope. Sorry. You need to have the S for that.
Mm-hmm. It is not able to work together.
No,
sorry.
No tuckies. Sorry.
Sorry.
Good question, though. Thinking
Great
outside
question.
The box.
Great question.
Like a R, aka the pirate.
So
see, I make these jokes all the time, and nobody thinks I'm funny. So
what's that?
Feel like a R as the pirate.
R.
That's like the M10R as the pirate M.
All right.
Ha! You laughed.
All right. Yes. So we didn't touch on this, and thank you for the reminder.
Yes.
Andy says I'm interested in the TL zooms, and a quick assessment. Can we cover those?
Of course. We've got them somewhere
right
in this pile of lenses.
You want me to hold them up and you talk about
them? So there are three zoom lenses for the TL system. There is the...
Got them right here.
11 to 23 millimeter, which is equivalent to a 16 to 35.
Get a close up here.
There is, all right, there it is. That's very, got a 67 millimeter filter thread size. It is fantastic. Then there is the 18 to 56 millimeter. That is equivalent to a 28 to 85. That is super small, super light, 52 millimeter filter thread size.
Surprisingly sharp and surprisingly really good sharp at the wide end.
And lastly, we have the 55 to 135 millimeter, equivalent to about an 80 to 200. That is an E60 filter size.
And this is it does extend pretty far here, but yes, it's nice and compact when it's collapsed.
The upside to these lenses is their performance is excellent. Mm-hmm. They're very, very light, and they're just easy. The downside is the apertures are not as fast as you get on a prime, because the objective with these lenses is to keep them light and compact.
Yeah, you can see, so I can easily...
If you're doing a lot of low light photography with the CL, I would have at least one CL prime, or
I'd have this one,
an M lens, yeah, 35-1.4, which is insane. But the 18-56 is surprisingly versatile. It's mm-hmm. an excellent focal length, and I want to emphasize this again. It's extremely small and extremely light.
Compare this. Yeah, let's compare this.
It's 256 grams.
So this is a full frame 24-90 SL. This is the 18-56, which is not quite as wide.
It's not as good. It's not as good either, but it's pretty darn close. And again, that weighs as much as a 35 Summicron M version 4, pretty much, which is like 260 grams. So it is very, very light. This actually works pretty well on an SL2 because it's just a light 20 megapixel compact zoom and, again, stabilized.
Well, I'd even argue for the 11-23.
This is my favorite. Well, I don't know. I like the 55 to 135. This is my tied for first place.
I think so.
Of the three.
I love this lens.
This lens is spectacular on the CL or on the SL2. Not so much on the original SL because it's 10 megs. And it's
and it focuses so ridiculously close to the front element.
Yeah. Yes. It goes down to, hold on, I have the specs
here. Like 0.2 meters?
0.2 meters. It's actually the closest focusing of any TL lens short of the 60 macro.
Right, so here is a little catch. And at 11 millimeters, it has such insanely wide depth of field, let's say at F8. So my little secret trick is I can just put this in places. So let's say you have like a rose bush or something, you know, imagine it's growing here. I'll just kind of shove this in there and just kind of wiggle around, take a few different angles and make sure the sun's overhead. And it gets a beautiful starburst behind there, and it looks like you're inside the plant. And I've done this and have inadvertently caught perfectly crisp bees, you know, buzzing around the flowers. So it's a fun lens.
Yeah. So if you've got either a CL, TL2, or an SL, don't be scared of the zooms. Obviously, if you shoot only in super low light, I'd probably go with a prime. Because there's certainly, that's the compromise. I want to answer... I think we've covered the zooms pretty well.
I'm
happy to go back to it if there's additional questions. No? So I got an email here from Mark who wants to know, the short version, what is essentially the highest quality full frame macro solution for the SL2 in a fine art reproduction environment? 120 macro S.
Well, that's going to be sharp. Edge to edge,
sharpest,
corner to corner.
Sharpest, best color production. It's the best, hands down. Mm-hmm. Because you don't give up any resolution. You still have autofocus, the flattest field.
The only thing is with a 120, because again, no crop factor, you're going to have to back up a bit.
Yeah, so it'll be a 120, but if you're in a studio environment, it does depend on the size of the artwork you're shooting, but if you have the space to back up, 120 macro S on the SL2 is the highest quality 47 megapixel macro solution. So.
But we would also caution, again, if you want that absolute pinnacle of sharpness, I'd probably stay at F8.
Yeah, well, if you're doing final repro, you're not shooting wide open anyway, so.
No, but also don't think stopping down is going to help you. So I would do F8.
Oh, I see what you mean, right.
Don't go beyond there. I'd say if you want to kind of balance the absolute best corner sharpness with the, you know, no chance of diffraction, stay 5.6 to F8.
Yeah.
That's for art repro, where it really matters.
Yeah. What else we got?
Will Leica update the SL2 to allow linear focus control in menu mode?
We hope so.
Well, there's an interesting question. So if you actually look in the menu of the SL2, it says focus mode and it just says standard and it's grayed out. The camera firmware actually supports linear focus. And the reason for that is it's a standard that's supported in the L-Mount Alliance. So the camera has to support it. What's not supported yet And I'm hoping it's one of these any day now, because I've heard it's any day now for a while, is that that's actually lens firmware dependent. So Leica needs to roll out lens firmware across the board for all the TL and SL lenses, which they're working on, to then maintain compatibility to what's already in both the CL and the SL2 in terms of the linear focus. Yeah. So not a camera problem,
right.
Lens firmware.
We do want that feature, and I'm sure we'll get it eventually. We can't speak for Leica in that case, obviously, but it's certainly something that's been discussed.
Absolutely.
It's something that pretty much everyone who needs to know is aware. Hi, Jimmy. Thanks for watching.
So let's see. Let's just to cover, we have talked about the SL primes.
Yes.
We've talked a little bit about the SL zooms.
We're just looking here.
We have talked about some of the R-mount lenses, TL lenses. A little bit. We didn't cover everything on TL. I do want to talk about the 35.
Well, let me ask you. I'll ask you. So first question, of all the CL, TL, APS-C lenses, right? There are two that are actually made in Germany.
Yes.
Which are those two?
So that's easy. Do I have them both here? I have one of them here.
Here.
There we go. So that is easy. Mm-hmm. That is the 35 1.4 Summilux TL and the 60 Apo Macro Elmerit.
Yes, these also happen to be our two favorites.
They are.
At least amongst the primes, because I consider the primes and the zooms to be different tools for different tasks. What do you like about that 35? Because that is, speak for you, the lens you probably use the most.
It is.
On the CL.
Yep.
And the lens I use quite a bit as well, and the one I took on my last trip.
Yep. So it is, now keep in mind, for an APS lens to be that big, I mean, this is massively large. If you scale this up, it would actually be bigger than the 24-90 in full frame if they made this same lens design. The fact that they only had to cover APS allowed them to put a really exotic optical design together and it still be really compact. For again, it's more sizable than all the rest of the TL lenses in terms of weight, right? Mm-hmm. So much we weigh
this
here.
One is 428 grams. It is only second to the 55-135 in terms
right.
of weight.
Which is a much bigger lens.
Yeah, and 55-135 feels lighter because it's
more larger. Spread out.
It's not as dense.
Right, this is a very dense lens, not 75 Noctilux dense. That thing is like a brick.
Yeah.
A beautiful brick, but a brick. So this one, it handles pretty well. On the front of the SL, it actually feels really feather light compared to any SL lens you could put on it.
Yeah, we'll pop it on the SL too.
Yeah, and then,
I'll take that.
There you go.
It's like 19 adapters. Here we go.
So Rube Goldberg right there.
But it does work.
Yeah, when I put it on here, actually it is really nicely balanced. It's a 60 millimeter front diameter, which is smaller than the 67 millimeter front diameter of the Apo Summicrons. And yeah, it just performs really well. And I'll say what I like about this versus say, do you have a...
This one.
Yeah.
You got it?
Yeah. So I'm just going to show you. And talking about full frame versus crop sensor, right? So this is one of my favorite M lenses, which I've talked about in previous episodes. And I know Josh loves this one too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is the, show you the other side. This is a 35 1.4 Summilux FLE. This is a 35 Summilux for the TL, which I show you. Now, what's really fascinating is, again, this is a full frame lens. This is a crop sensor lens. Again, just to give you an idea of how massive this would be if it was a full frame lens. It's incredible. It would basically be like if they made a Noctilux, you know, 35.
Oh, whatever. Don't start down that road.
All right. Hypothetically speaking.
Yes.
So anyway, it's a really fantastic design. And some people will say, well, you own a 35 1.4 M lens, which is a phenomenal lens. You've said it's one of your favorite and most used M lenses. It is, and it is. But the TL lens does one thing very specifically that the M lens does not. The M lens minimum focus distance, because it is a rangefinder coupled lens, goes down to the rangefinder minimum of 0.7 meters. That's not a big deal in M, but this one goes down to 0.3 meters on minimum focus. not only does it go to 0.3 meters, but it's excellent quality at wide open, at minimum focus distance, and the focus fall off and the bokeh is better than the 35mm. It just is, because physics. I can focus in less than half the distance with the same aperture, the same focal length, and I'm able to get much better focus fall off. A lot of the video work that we've done on location, especially when I was shooting with the SL601, which only did an APS crop sensor, Super 35, almost, I'd say maybe 80% of all the video work I did on the SL601 was with this lens. Not with an SL lens, but with the TL lens. Because it's just so flexible and it focuses so close and looks so beautiful. So I love this lens. It's great. It hits way above its
We need to talk about something totally unrelated, but still very important.
Oh, the the sweepstakes.
So if you've watched any of the past 19 or 18 other episodes of Red Dot Forum Camera Talk, you know we frequently owe a debt to the Leica Historical or International Leica Society, sorry, LHSA, for providing tons of amazing loaner lenses and cameras for us to show everybody to help keep the show interesting. So,
but there's something really cool going on.
The LHSA does a couple of really, well, a lot of really cool things. One of the coolest things is a sweepstakes. Mm-hmm. And the last one was an M10 monochrome. Mm-hmm. And the current one is for an M10R.
Well, pop up. We've got, there we go.
You don't want to see us. So you can enter the sweepstakes. Is there a link in the description or?
I'll put it in there.
Okay, he will. David will put a link into the description. You do not have to be a member, I believe, to enter.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
And you can buy, you can buy any number of tickets.
Uh-huh.
They give discounts for more tickets bought.
So if you want to enter to win an M10R, and then call us to buy some M lenses for it, totally fine. But either way, the LHSA is an incredible organization. It's a great resource for learning about Leica equipment, especially vintage equipment. They do shoots and they do events and all kinds of really, really cool stuff.
We've got a virtual meeting coming up very shortly, actually.
Yeah, David has been a member. He's been on the board. He's been donated a lot of his time to the organization. And we really appreciate everything they've done both for the show and for the Leica community at large.
It's a great resource.
David will drop a link. Otherwise, you can just Google.
But listen,
LHSA.
Where else are you going to have an opportunity, like a legit legal opportunity to possibly get, you know, an $8,000 camera for $25?
Yeah, pretty nice.
No strings.
And you're supporting a great organization that supports a brand and that you love. So.
So Kirsten dropped a link in the chat, in live chat.
Look at that.
I'll make sure to do it in the permanent video description as well. So after you're watching this live, you'll also be able to scroll down and see that. For now, look to the some side of us for the chat, like below or whatever.
Yeah.
And click that link, enter, because I think there's 2 days until the...
Is it soon? You want to click on it and soon? Or do we risk breaking something?
I don't think I'm going to break anything.
Okay.
The sweepstakes is open until...
September 29th. You have 3 days left to enter.
3 days left.
No, 2.5. It's almost the end of the night. We should probably take one or two more questions. We have been going, although I guess we lost a bit from
lost
the
a little bit,
crash.
But
Sandy asked a question, which I will answer quickly.
Okay, what do we got?
There is no native tilt shift or PC perspective control lenses for the L-mount. The 28R lens doesn't really have enough movement to be worthwhile. I've seen or heard of people using Canon or Nikon tilt shift lenses with adapters. I don't have experience with that, so.
I mean, the only experience I have is the Canon 17 TSE is quite a well-regarded lens.
If you've done that and have anything cool to show, feel free to drop a link in the comments. We're always curious about
Get a NovaFlex EOS adapter.
Yeah.
And I think that would actually be more convenient because the tilt-shift Canon lenses don't have electronic aperture. I think they're manual.
Yeah. Well, we don't really know the latest because we're kind of out.
Yeah, or you could get a Nikon NovaFlex adapter.
And one of the older Nikon
Just like the 24 PC.
But there's no native, the short answer is there's no native L-mount solution for tilt-shift. I don't know if there ever will be. I think it's just too specific for Leica to ever do. You could always get
Nikon or Canon.
Leica S120 TS, but that's really more for tabletop work.
No.
It's not.
I wouldn't do that. I'd honestly recommend some of the newer style, better optical designs from Nikon and Canon and using a NovaFlex adapter.
Yeah.
That'd
any other burning questions? So, nope. Well, David looks. So this is our 19th episode. And our 10th episode, we did an Ask Us Anything, which ended up being really successful and fun. So we're going to keep that trend going for our every 10. So next episode, 2 weeks from now, is episode 20, which is insane. And we are going to do another Ask Us Anything. So if you have questions about anything we've covered in the past 19 episodes, anything we haven't covered, Leica-related, computer-related, any dog-related, whatever, you know.
Watch-related?
Don't want to go down that rabbit hole. That will be the opportunity to do that. Obviously, we're all available regular days as well, but if you want to ask us something on air 2 weeks from now, which is October...
I have a calendar. I have the technology.
October 10th will be our 20th episode.
Hooray!
Amazing. That'll be our Ask Us Anything. And then we're getting into another three-part series. Mm-hmm. I think it's three parts, although we have tendency to extend that. We're going to call it our Gearing Up for series. Mm-hmm. I don't want to spoil everything, but it'll be basically our tips and tricks to gear up for various types of photography from our experience doing that with Leica.
Kind of a interactive what's in our bag, but our thought process, and also how you can build a kit from different systems to do that thing.
Yes, yes. So that is coming up after episode 20. It should be a lot of fun. As always, you know, if you have requests or ideas for future episodes, things you want to see us talk about for 2 hours on end, tell us, because we love to hear feedback and we want to make sure that what we're talking about is relevant for people that are watching. So what else?
Oh,
what else?
October 10th is the second day of the LHSA meeting. So maybe it won't be October 10th.
Well, we have to look at the schedule.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye.
We'll figure it out.
As always, you should subscribe to Red Dot Forum channel so you know that when we post new content, when we're going to go live, we really appreciate that. We've been steadily growing our subscriber base, which we thank you very much for continuing to tune in and listening to us ramble ad nauseum about all this amazingly cool stuff.
We love it.
That we are just so passionate about and happy that we can share it with all of you. So please subscribe, give us a thumbs up, and be sure we have, what, how many did you say? 19? 18? We have 18 previous Red Dot Forum Camera Talk episodes.
Yeah.
All archived on the channel, and you can go back and watch any of them.
Or all of them.
Or all
40
of them.
Hours of amazing content.
Yep.
That's insane.
Check out specific to L-Mount. I have all those links in the video description. So if you want to look at a review of the 90-280 or the 75 Apo, we've got it all there. If you want to look at a review of the SL or the CL, we've got it there. Lots of interviews and show coverage from when there used to be photo shows. So we've got lots and lots of content. If you want to dive further, learn more about CL, TL, SL, S, it's all there for you. And in the meantime, before our next episode, please leave us a comment. If you have any questions that we weren't able to address in our super short episode here, I monitor those throughout the next couple weeks and will do my best to answer your questions the best that I can or that Josh can. And until then, enter the sweepstakes because everyone can use an M10R. And a big thank you to Josh, as always.
Thank you. And Jose.
A big thank you to Jose.
And Kirsten.
Thank you, Kirsten. And all of you for tuning in and watching. We appreciate it. And we will see you next time.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.